the December 13th school committee meeting to order. Chairman or Chair Borowski is going to be a little late, so I'll get things started. First, I'd like to know if there's anything that's not on the agenda for public input. Come up now. And the consent agenda. Does anyone have anything they'd like to take? Yes.
I'd like to take the minutes from 12-8 off the consent agenda.
Okay. So there's a motion to take the minutes from, or actually, can you read the consent agenda first?
I move to approve the consent agenda as presented.
The motion pending to remove the minutes from 12-8.
After, is there a second on that?
Second.
Okay. You wanted to take the December 8th. Does anyone have any questions on that? Move to, yes.
Well, I'd like to know what the questions are.
Just typographical error. The question is, can I correct a typographical error?
Can you want to tell Linda what just so?
Sure. Yeah, no, the motion carried 5-0. There were six members present voting, so it would be 6-0 for both. On the bottom of page one. So both motions would carry 6-0. Thank you.
Okay, we'll vote on the motion to approve the consent agenda as amended. All those in favor? 5-0. And now we'll have reports. Have any student reports? Are there any committee reports tonight? Dr. Doxter.
I have two. One is about Dr. Olivardia, who presented at the CPAC meeting last month. He presented on ADHD and dyslexia, and there were over 113 or around 113 people, and there was a lot of staff present, including our Pupil Services Director, Carolyn Wilson. He was very knowledgeable, both from the research base and also from personal experience, because that was his diagnosis. And parents were very engaged. They asked very pointed questions. Many asked questions and challenges from other communities that were not shared challenges in the Reading district, so it was very interesting and enlightening. One thing that struck me was how he straddled many different roles. He was a person with these challenges, a parent of children with these diagnoses, and an expert on the topic as well. And I was really, his advice was assuming positive intent and stressed how hard it is for all involved to create the perfect solutions given the different perspectives and resources coming together at IEP meetings and in programs for students. And his advice is that all involved try to work together for the student's best potential. But he didn't do that by selling anyone short. He kept acknowledging how hard that is, which I think is the reality. There are pressures acting on everyone, and so I thought that was very helpful advice, and people left there in great discussions and feeling, I think, like they learned a lot. Right now, simultaneous with this meeting, there's also a CPAC meeting going on discussing basic rights. And I don't know if Mrs. Wilson has more to add.
You've covered it.
Okay, and then my second report is that the Human Relations Advisory Committee continues their work preparing for the Martin Luther King Day event, which is on January 16th. There will be soon an invitation to organizations if they want to have an exhibit table, following through with Martin Luther King's challenge that the most important thing we do is to help others in our community. And so if there are organizations out there that would like to have an exhibit table at this event, the exhibit tables happen during the breakfast time. The goal is that people will mix and learn more about what's happening in our community, and not just sort of cluster in the people they know, but be learning more about our community. And we have wonderful performers from locally and afar, and we hope everybody plans to come. It's a family event. It's free. There'll be breakfast. And it's from 9:30 till 11:30. 9:30 to 10 is breakfast, and the exhibit tables, and 10 to 11:30 is the program.
Thank you.
The other reports.
I think haven't had a committee meeting, or have we, since the RACASA screening of Breaking Point?
That was the same night as that. So no, we have not.
Oh, okay, then.
It's a lot of good stuff competing.
So it was, there was a great panel at Breaking Point. It was a relatively, the documentary is focused on really the impacts to students for use of prescription drugs that are not prescribed for them, and there's a significant focus on Ritalin and Adderall, and it's extremely informative if you haven't understood, you know, what happens when a person who in general doesn't need a prescription medication takes a medication. But the panel discussion afterwards was really excellent. It was a relatively small group of people, but the questions were just really outstanding, and they went to a depth that I've been to a lot of the RACASA events since I serve on that board, and I've rarely seen the questions and answers get to the depth that they did. And it was just really a rich discussion that went on, you know, for quite some time. And the experts that were there, one of which was our school social worker, John, can you help
Susan
me?
Hooper.
Susan Hooper, and there were two psychologists from the area, and a practitioner from one of the support houses. But I learned also a lot about what Susan Hooper does in our district that I didn't know, and was really amazed at. So I just would really overall encourage people. We put these programs together to educate parents, to inform the community. And I would encourage people to attend them. There just really weren't enough people in the room. And it's information that's important to all of us. And there were parents there who have had only very young children, and one parent who asked a question that was relative to a teenage problem. And when he went to clarify, you know, someone said, could clarify that a little bit. He said, well, I actually can't clarify, but I told a friend, a parent that I work with, that I was coming to this, and they asked me to ask you all this question. And afterwards, he said that he was really glad that he didn't miss it, because he might not have had he not sort of committed to getting that question answered for the teenage youth, because his kids are a little young, and maybe, you know, I don't really need to learn about this right now. But it was incredibly informative, and I know that it actually caused me to go back and have more direct conversations with my own college-age sons about really the misuse of those commonly prescribed drugs, because, you know, it's a fallacy. It will make you feel like you're performing, and it will cause your deterioration of performance. So it was excellent, and I just really wish we could get a better turnout. The obituaries aren't where we want people to be paying attention. We want them to pay attention when we're trying to offer, how can you change your life, change your child's life.
Yes.
I understood that it was taped. Was it taped and put on RCTV?
It was taped. I'd have to ask Erica. I definitely do know that it was videotaped. And so you could definitely, I would highly recommend that as a program to watch, other than some other stuff that's on TV lately.
Well, you know, I'd just like to add to that. I was there, and you know, having, as others do in this room, two freshmen that are now cramming this week to get ready for their finals, and it makes you stop to think. I mean, I didn't think of those things. You know, you think of the opioids and all that, but you don't stop to think about kids sharing their you know, their ADHD medications, so that others can stay up all night to study. So made you stop to think. It was a good, very good discussion.
Excellent discussion. Just a comment. Well, I did not attend it. I've been to many events similar to that. Not most recently, but and put on events like that. And I totally agree with what Elaine says. It's really frustrating to put a lot of time and effort in and just have a minimal amount of people really there. It's great that there's some people there, but maybe there's got to be some brainstorming with our CASA and the school department in terms of, you know, what can you do to time it up a little bit better or require it, which happens in some school districts.
Mm-hmm. Any other reports?
You're going to pass? Yeah, I can see why. I have three things. Just wanted to update the committee on a couple of things. One, I'm in my third week of holding office hours. My goal has been to try to do at least one in a school each week. Out of the two I do two a week, usually during a time when it's drop off or pick up. So I'm making the rounds to trying to hit every school over the next few weeks, and have been able to reach most of the elementary schools now and one of the middle schools, actually both of the middle schools now. And also have had some on Saturday. So I've had a few people come. I've had some very good discussions about things like special education budget, FY18 budget, and some other items. Technology was another one. So they've been pretty good discussions, and I think it's just another way to reach out to the community and see if there's any questions that can be answered or that they can understand more about the schools. We have been publishing it in the newspaper each week. We've been sending it out on Sunday for that week to the school parents. So we are trying to get putting it on the blog, so we're trying to get the word out as much as possible that these do exist. Miss Fiorello and I were able to attend last Tuesday the Youth Opioid Summit, which was held at Songus Arena in Lowell. We brought the child development class, and members of the Interact Club went to the event. It was sponsored by the Wahlberg Foundation and several other organizations. And it also showed the movie If Only, which was shown here in Reading a few, several months ago now, probably a year ago, I think we saw it, which was produced by James Wahlberg. It was filmed in this area, the greater Lowell area. There was also several, celebrities who spoke of their struggles with substance abuse. Jeff Allison, who was a promising pitcher out of Peabody, who made it to the big leagues but then wasn't able to fulfill his dream. We also heard from ex-Patriots Matt Light, Troy Brown, there were several other people that spoke in addition to the movie. So it was a morning session, and there was about 4,000 students from area high schools and middle schools that attended. And then finally, the last couple of weeks, all of our kindergarten students have been able to be part of our Rotary Reader Project, which is the third year we've been doing this now, where members of the Reading Rotary Club go and read to the kindergarten students in each of the classes, and then also give them a book bag with two books in it and some tips on how to encourage reading at home. So this is something that took the place of the thesaurus that used to be given out to third graders, since a thesaurus really isn't something. I mean, you can get the thesaurus online now. So Rotary decided a few years ago to shift to providing reading books for kindergarten students and encourage literacy. So that's been happening the last couple of weeks, and I want to thank the Rotary Club for making that donation of the book bags and the books and doing the reading with all the students. So that's my report.
I have a quick one. I watched it a little bit late, so I hope it didn't come up. But did anybody talk about Nick's taking on the Board of Selectmen liaison? Did that come up?
No.
Oh, then I will bring it up to the committee. Nick reached out to me since being appointed to his new position. and said he would be happy to take on any responsibility that Julie Joyce was carrying. She was our liaison to the Board of Selectmen, so Nick has agreed to take that over. So I just wanted to make that announcement, and thank you for stepping up and doing that.
Glad to do it.
Okay, our next item on the agenda is the social emotional transformation grant presentation.
So I'm going to do a short intro, and I'm going to turn it over to Sarah, who's going to do the first part of the presentation. What we have decided to do this evening is to update the committee in a variety of topics that are related to the multi-tiered system of support. And you can see that we have several people presenting this evening. Sarah, who's our director of social emotional learning. I will be talking a little bit about the framework itself. Lynn Dunn is going to talk about the ESPERT process, which we piloted this year as part of the new opioid law. Courtney Fogarty, our data coach, is going to be presenting to you some data, but also talking about some of the practices that we've been doing. Christian Huizenga, along with some of the health educators here, are going to talk about the health education curriculum, K-12. And Erica will be here shortly, is my understanding. And she'll be talking about some of the new programs that are going on with the Reading Coalition Against Substance Abuse. So this is going to be the breakdown of the presentation. What we're trying to do is, and this is connected to when I presented to you the district improvement plan and the superintendent's goals. So you're going to see some familiarity tonight, but that's on purpose because we want to show you the connection of everything we're doing, that there is a coherence for all the presentations that you are seeing that is connected to our district improvement plan and the goal and the four focus areas. So I'm going to turn this over now to Sarah, and she is going to take it from here.
Actually, let's see, can I make this back for a second? Yeah, I love this slide, John. I'm just going to go back for a second because, yeah, we're using the school transformation grant as an anchor for the conversation, but for the past 3 years, we've actually been using the work of the grant to expand upward and outward. And so I think this presentation helps to show that and demonstrate that we didn't want to start from here and then show you all the different directions. We wanted to try to come at it from a comprehensive way. So John was saying what you heard about last week is going to come up in this presentation as well. But it is all connected because we realized through doing the school transformation grant work that we are now able to embed it in just the practices of what we do as a school district. And so it's now coming up and popping up in all of the things we do. And so it is a grant report out, but it's now conveniently just a school-wide report out on student success. So here we go. So how did this all begin? I find that I say these slides over and over again, so I go through them so quickly. And I don't know if we've got so many opportunities built in for questions. Previously, when we've done this, we've interrupted with slides for questions, and I don't think we have them built in until the very end. So if you find that we're at a point where you have burning questions, just jump in and let us know. But I'll try to paint a nice picture. So back in 2011 or so, in Reading, we started to have a number of community discussions, a number of world cafes, and really that's when behavioral health started to bubble up to the surface. And as a community, we had some community violence. We lost some young people in our community to some violence. And we had hundreds of people, tons of citizens, whether they were parents or not, really concerned about Reading and wanting to see what can we do, how do we change this, we need to be involved. And so we started some community discussions. From that, we formed a behavioral health task force back in 2011 that looked like 26 plus people who were representative of all the different levels. We had pre-K through 12, we had teachers, we had administrators, we had people from school psychology sides, guidance, everything you can imagine, community members. And we used something called the Behavioral Health Self-Assessment Tool, which was something that the Department of Ed had come up with using a lot of different models. They still use it to this day. We actually still used it this past year to revisit where we were and how much progress we had made. The Behavioral Health and Public Schools Tool looks at six functions of school processes to see how well we are using them to support student success, specifically through the lens of behavioral health. So how well we use our leadership, our professional learning, our access to resources and services, our academic and non-academic time, our policies, our procedures, our protocols, and our family collaboration. How well do we do those school functions to make sure we're serving students specifically with behavioral health needs? And we use that to generate a list of recommendations. Those were all made public. They're still public on our websites, actually, if you wanted to look up in the archives, they're out there. And we use those then to create our action plan for the next 3 years or so. We shop those action plan items around to the community. We brought them to all the PTO meetings. We brought them to all the staff meetings, actually, brought them to the CPAC. I'm trying to think of all the groups we brought them to. Another World Cafe. And we got everyone to help give feedback about priority. And from that, we created our 3-year action plan. And then we got to work, started working on all those different recommendations that were there. And about 2 years, a year and a half in, we started realizing that it was a really robust list, because we like to do a lot of things and we like to do them really well. So we were very comprehensive. We started to notice that all the pieces started to connect. You know, one of them was about communication. One of them was about communication using data. One of them was, we need a nice data system. One of them was, we need data to be early. We need it to be comprehensive. We need it to be in all different areas. And the wires were crisscrossing, and that if we really did one well, it was actually going to impact 6 or 7 other items on the list. And we started to see that it was actually more of, less of a laundry list and more of a system. And it really resonated with us that it was actually very close to this thing called a multi-tiered system of supports. So about a year and a half in this laundry list of action planning, we moved towards something called the multi-tiered system of supports. So keep that journey in your mind, and we'll get to that model in just a moment. But why behavioral health? You know, so I started bringing up behavioral health. You understand the urgency that Reading was in back into about 6 years or so ago. And yes, there's always urgency when something is trendy, when something's the flavor of the month. That's always a why. But 6 years later, why are we still doing this? Why is this still something that's important to us? Even if it's not on the front page, and yes, we're still going to have violence, we're still going to have loss, and we're still going to have individual stories that we can all tell that are meaningful to us. But just like you said, Elaine, you know, we shouldn't be responding to obituaries, we should be responding to prevention. And that's why we are doing this. Because all of these kids are our kids, and because although we cannot change the circumstances of the world around us, we cannot change the circumstances that our students are growing up in right now, or the way that the world is unfolding before us, what we can do is take advantage of being a school system. Schools are amazing, amazing places. We can be the great equalizer. We can be this fantastic place that really provides amazing, amazing services for students. And so Robert Putnam says in his book, Our Kids, which the administrative council really spent the summer reading this past summer and diving into to help us steep our minds and our hearts in before we dove into 2016 and 17 school year. And he says it here too, you know, that the gap is created for students by more than what happens to the kids before they get to school, by things that happen outside of school, and by what they bring or don't bring with them. And it's by what schools do to them. He argues, however, that even if schools aren't part of the problem, they could be a bigger part of the solution. And that's why we're doing this, because we can be a bigger part of the solution. Not only that, this is where my brainy part really loves all of the science and research around this. This is just a quick snapshot. If you really wanted to know more about it, there's a ton of information on this. If I was to give you the Cliff's Notes, the science says that doing this work, which everyone here is going to speak about, creating healthy students is actually the number one thing we can do to create smart, high-achieving, well-adapted students. That actually creating healthy students is the first thing we need to do before we can educate students. And that's what all the research says. These are all the ways that we are going to create healthy students. This is what we know about how to make it happen, but this is what we know we need to do. We need to create healthy spaces in order to have healthy students. Two examples. What we know from the ACEs studies, and I know John shared this with you all a couple weeks ago or a couple meetings ago, the Adverse Childhood Experiences studies, is that we know at least 50% of our students have had an adverse childhood experience, at least one adverse childhood experience. And what we know about that is that it actually changes the neurobiology of the brain. It actually changes the structures inside of your brain and how you learn, ends up divesting some of the brain power that you spend attending to learning in your prefrontal cortex, all of that higher order thinking, and it keeps it back in your animal brain, your fight, flight, freeze piece of your brain. So what we need to be doing in our schools is training our teachers and creating spaces that allow brains, this wonderful flexibility of the brain, to short circuit it back to being able to say, okay, we've got that. We understand that this is what happens when you have a trauma experience. We're gonna work with that knowledge. We're gonna create a space that allows your brain to get back online so you're now ready and available to learn. If you have somebody who's frozen, they're not gonna learn, no matter how fantastic of an educator you are. So that's what we know from trauma and from adverse childhood experiences. What we also know, in 2011, there was this amazing meta-analysis study where they looked at the impact of all the different classroom practices you can do, all the great interventions we can do, and they looked at everything on the impact they had on achievement, on student achievement, and they looked at classroom size, they looked at the type of curriculum, they looked at the type of teacher, the type of the school building, all of that, and across the board, they found that above and beyond everything else, what had the largest bang for your buck, what actually increased achievement the most, was having a social-emotional learning program in place. That increased achievement by 11%. It wasn't having a tutor, it wasn't having a small class size, it was by having a comprehensive social-emotional learning program in place. So we know not only is it having a healthy environment, but actually learning skills about how to adapt and take care of your body and how to exist in a social environment. So that's what we are now doing, and that's what we are endeavoring to do in Reading. This is the why. So then, how do we actually put that in place? And that's where we came up across the multi-tiered system of supports. MTSS is that acronym then. We throw out a lot of alphabet soup, right? MTSS is the acronym we talk about a lot. This is what we're talking about. Whether it be circles, whether it be triangles, MTSS is the organizational framework that allows us to do all of this stuff in a way that's going to reach all of our students in the most effective way, that's going to make the best use of our staff, of our time, of our resources, without anybody spinning their wheels needlessly. And it's based on science, and it's equitable. Everyone gets what they need when they get it, as soon as they get it, nothing more, nothing less. That's the idea. So the way we've organized our presentation is actually based in the circles here, because this is something we've also shared with you last year. Hopefully this is a familiar structure, that we all have the same outcome. Right, our outcome is this overarching piece of we want our students to have social competence and academic achievement. That's what our goal is as a school district, as a community, that's what we want to achieve. The way we're gonna do it is we're gonna align our systems, our data, and our practices in service of that larger outcome. We understand the definition of systems, data, and practices, but when we're talking about MTSS, I like the definition of systems is anything that's in place to support our staff. So anything that we have in place that supports our staff, that's a system. We need to make sure we're supporting our staff in order to achieve our outcomes. Data is anything that's in place that supports our decision making. So, you know, it might not be data driven. I know sometimes that's a tough one, but we need data to make decisions, and that can be quantitative, it can be qualitative, whatever it might be. How are we making our decisions? And then our practices is whatever we do to support our student behavior. So that could be curriculum, that could be interventions. What are the practices that we have in place? And all three need to work together. We need to focus on all three of them. And here's just another, I know you have the slides too, so feel free to dive into it deeper if I'm going through it too quickly. But ultimately, this is another way that you can read about how they all come together. Beautiful. Outcomes, you know, John talked about this last time. These are a lot of the things that are in our district improvement plan. Those are our outcomes, the targets, the measurable pieces that we're working towards. Data is the information we're gonna monitor to get us there. Courtney's gonna talk about that. Practices, we're gonna have some folks speak about those systems. We're gonna give you some examples of all of these today to help illustrate how they work together. And really when it comes to MTSS and why we use it as an organizational piece is because all of these little elements can seem as disparate items in a shopping cart. They can seem really disconnected. You know, you have to recruit and hire people. You have to have teams at the school and district level. You have to have policy. You have to use your data, evaluate your staff. You have to have coaching and professional development. And this can be overwhelming and so much, and you can lose the thread. And really what the multi-tiered system of support allows you to do is align all of that in service of one major goal. And it's tremendous, because then instead of trying to maintain thousands of different disconnected pieces, they all come together as part of a larger framework. It organizes things beautifully. It just works better with the human mind, and with organizational structures like this when you're working with so many moving parts and so many people. And you'll notice here too, although I've been talking about behavior and social-emotional learning, it is a blended academic and behavioral model. Although we know we need to have healthy students in order to make them available to learn, the multi-tiered system is also in service of academic learning. We're talking about universal academics as well as interventions for academics. The framework is blended academics and non-academics. The structure is in service of all aspects of a student's day, not just their social-emotional aspect of who they are. This just reinforces what we were saying. It's a framework. It's a continuum. So we're also not talking about standalone programs. Nobody up here tonight is just going to talk about one program. We're talking about all of the different pieces of it. So it's a curriculum at tier one. It's a standalone intervention at tier two. It is a one-on-one support structure at tier three. And then everything in between. Sometimes students are moving flexibly between one and between the other. Sometimes you have a whole class that needs something more than curriculum. Well, you're not going to have that whole class flood somebody's office for a tier two intervention. You need to then come up with some flexible way of giving them something more. And so you need something else on the continuum, and that's what we work on. It's academic and it's behavioral, and we're working with all students. This isn't a special ed program. This isn't an out-of-district placement. This is something that exists for everybody. You can be on an IEP and have full access to everything that's within a multi-tiered system of supports. That's actually how this works beautifully. And this is that universal triangle that many of you have seen many, many times, which just gives you the visual of what we're talking about. The majority of students are well served by what is offered at that universal tier one preventative support. And then about 15% or so need a little more, and 5% or so need even more on top of that. And also, this is a nice representation to think about throughout the school day. 80% of the day is spent delivering services to the majority of students, with then a smaller percentage of the time delivering some additional pieces, thinking about it in that way as well. You know, the major focus here being the preventative work. What are we delivering to all students? How do we lift all boats? We often hear staff saying we're growing the green. We're trying to lift all boats and raise that green level, that green line. So that's the theory, the practice, the model. Where did this all come from? You know our story. We sort of got a little extra gas in the tank in 2014?
14.
Because we applied for a federal grant, and we received a really generous award of a little over $250,000 every year for 5 years. So we are in the midst of year three of this grant. We are one of three districts in Massachusetts to have their award. We are one of 78 awards in the country, and this is the first time this program has existed. So we're also the first cohort of the award to go out, which is really exciting. We're also, this was in tangent with another two-year award called Project AWARE, which you have all heard a lot about, which was the Youth Mental Health First Aid Award, where we have successfully trained over 600 people, right? Do you have the final number? Do you know it? 630 people in 2 years have been trained as mental health first aiders in the community in tandem with this. And that's another reason why we received this award, is because we were given preference because we also applied for the Youth Mental Health First Aid piece. The idea being is once we're building the larger system and now we're flooding our community with people who can identify, they're referring to a system that's now going to be able to actually meet their needs. They're working hand in hand. So that's tremendous. So our major goals here are really, each of these are just further descriptors of achieving the model that I've just laid out to you. These are the goals that we have outlined in our grant. What that looks like, every year we have to report out to the federal government on a number of different data points. Things such as decrease in office disciplinary referrals, improvement in attendance rates, such as different numbers such as suspensions, expulsions, specifically those related to drugs and alcohol, how many of our buildings are implementing a multi-tiered system of supports as well, specifically in relation to things like the social-emotional learning programs along those lines too. We also have to look at disproportionality between subgroups of ethnicity, race, socioeconomic status, disability, any place where we might be disproportionately disciplining anybody as well. And we have found some discrepancies the past few years, which is also something that Dr. Doherty shared out, two of our buildings in particular, and so we're also taking a deeper look at those this year to see what we can be doing to correct for that.
Can I ask a quick question?
Yes, please.
Is gender included in that list of groups that you would look at?
Yeah, you know, it's the way it's listed is any disproportionality, so it's on us to look at our own, because every demographic is totally different. You know, we don't have some subgroups that other communities and other states have, and so we, it's up to us to take a look at our demographics and then basically to run any subgroup based on our subgroups. We don't, some buildings do have disproportionality, now that I'm thinking about it as I run through, by gender, yes.
Okay, thanks.
We do. So we also have to take a look at that. Thank you for being there. We're still jumping in those conversations because our data system and the state's, conveniently, the state's reporting for discipline has also changed the past few years, so we're also trying to work on our fidelity of data collection. So we've had some hiccups the first few years with just making sure everyone's on the same page with what we're looking at and we're all talking the same, speaking the same language. It's a really good question. And presently, this is what the grant is funding for us. There's always slight variation in terms of things like in regards to conferences, the different conferences that come up. But the major items that stay the same every year, Director of Social Emotional Learning and MTSS Project Director, District Data Coach, the MTSS District Facilitators and Coaches stipends, the Building Leadership Team stipends. So we have building leadership teams of 8+ at every building level. Summer hourly meeting time compensation for the work that happens over the summer. Training that happens for every elementary level teacher, classroom teacher, as well as specialist. Restorative justice training, and then all the other PBIS conferences, MTSS conferences, restorative justice, all the other things that come up that people end up going to. Mindfulness conferences. And then the external coaching contracts we have with WIDECO, the May Institute, UConn, and our technology licenses with Baseline Edge and Swiss. Those are presently, and external coaching with, Jean Thompson Grove. That's not on there. I forgot about that one. So this is presently what the grant is funding for us and has been historically the past few years. And it's cut off at the top. Department of Elementary and Secondary Education has a number of different academies. They're trying to build capacity at the state level. So what they have actually been doing is, below us, Connecticut received one of the state version grants of what we have as a district. And so what we have all been encouraged to do by the federal government is take advantage of the 5 years we have it and build our local and regional capacity around us as much as possible. So when the money is gone, we can still lean on one another as best as we can. So some of the folks, if you see in this list, actually some of our trainers from WIDECO are going to Connecticut to get their training from them from the grant free so that they can continue to have training come back here and provide some TA assistance to us, which is great. Similarly, our state is able to provide to us, free of charge to us, all of these academies because of our involvement at the federal government as well as our level 3 status and a couple of other different qualifiers. So we've found different avenues into offerings at the state level. These aren't open season, these aren't open to everybody, but because we've found different pockets, and one of them being the grant, we've been able, UDL is because of the grant, PBIS is because of the grant, and Pyramid is because of the grant. So we've been able to plug into some wonderful 3-year training programs through this state. What they offer is full days of coaching, training for coaches, full days of training for teams, and on-site consultation with external coaches, and they come to the building and they work with them. So we have three of our buildings, potentially we're working on the specifics because some of them are new, so involved in those academies, which is great. They're all using a multi-tiered system template, organizational framework, and they're all focusing on different content areas at first, but they're all building the same organizational structure, which is fantastic. And presently, in terms of social-emotional learning curriculum in Reading, just to let you know, we have at the high school, the health curriculum has social emotional units where they talk about mental health, they talk about healthy relationships, responsible decision making, a number of things, and Katie, you can speak better to that than I can. There are also developmental guidance workshops, which have been newly implemented this year, which are fantastic. They're starting mostly at career and college readiness, hoping to use this as a template, as an opportunity to pilot it, and then once we, you know, get our feet on the ground, expand it to cover more of the social-emotional competencies. Facing History in Ourselves is an elective currently offered at the 12th grade. It's a really well-received course, but it's only offered as an elective. The fantastic thing about Facing History in Ourselves is it's a research-based social-emotional learning program that's recommended by CASEL. CASEL is the nationally recognized social-emotional learning and academic organization. And so it's really fascinating that we have that, and it's been here for a number of years as an elective at the high school, but only in that one little pocket. So we've been partnering, the middle school principals have been partnering with Jim DeBenedictis, who's the instructor at the high school who's been doing it, and learning from him about how we can be piloting it at the middle schools, and we've been working with them to pilot it in 2017 because it's also a 6-12 curriculum, and we'd love to have some continuity from the middle school to the high school with that program. In the elementary school, we have Open Circle going strong. It's been really great down there, K-5. All of our staff have been beautifully trained. The grant continues to fund the upkeep of that so that all of our new staff are trained in that. We're looking into a sustainability model too, where we could have some trainers in-house trained so we can have some ongoing training in-house so that once the grant's gone, we can just continue to do that on our own. And then at the preschool level, we have Yoga for Classrooms. Our preschool director has also become a trainer now, so we have two in-district trainers for that program, which is phenomenal. And we also have the second step program there, and they're also going into the pyramid model, so they're going to have a lot of tools in their toolbox. They also completed their SEL, so those social emotional learning standards and approaches to play and learning standards training, okay, because Massachusetts now has standards for social emotional learning at the pre-K and K level, standalone social emotional learning standards as a state, at the state level, which is new as of June last year, 2015. And all of our pre-K staff have been trained in that. So that's a really great thing for them. So that's my laying of the land for you all.
One more
please
quick question.
Do.
On the previous slide on Open Circle, I have a question about fidelity.
Yes.
So you talked about everyone's trained and there's a plan in place to how to make that happen. How do you measure how consistently across five schools and all those grades that curriculum is being implemented?
Beautiful. So this past summer, the elementary principals sat down and came up with a consistent, they had a conversation about instructional minutes and how they were going to make sure that every student would have the same delivery of making sure everybody had the same amount of minutes on time. So every elementary student gets the 30 minutes of Open Circle every week that's required by the program for fidelity. In some buildings, it's 2 15 doses. In some buildings, it's 1:30. The program allows for both. It actually says either delivery is consistent with their model. We also have it built into the SEL action plan that if a teacher has that as part of their plan, some of the observations happen during their Open Circle time as well. We encourage the specialists who are not teaching during that time. It's often built in that they're asked to go and sit in the open chair because Open Circle model, there's always an open chair there, and we invite people to come sit and join the circle. I've had the opportunity to jump in on a number of them, and I'm still excited to go see more because I have to see more. But that's a big piece of the fidelity, is knowing that everyone has it scheduled into their actual class day now, which hadn't historically been the case for everybody, but that is now the case for everybody, which is a change in practice, which allows for that, eliminated a lot of the barriers.
Thank you.
Yeah, absolutely.
I have a question.
Yeah.
Oh, like, who's acknowledging? Oh, Chuck is acknowledging today.
I know, I always call on people and forget. I don't get to call on you.
I have, this may be too early, and if that's the case, then it'll, you know, the rest of the presentation, but I sort of want to make sure that I walk away from this with a picture of what this all really means to a teacher in a classroom, and I realize that depends whether you're elementary, middle, or high school, so ideally I'd like to understand it from all three, but what does it mean in terms of the support that they get as a teacher, and what does it mean for sort of the work of doing this? What does that look like? So maybe that will be, we'll get that picture as we go along.
I think you're going to see that picture as we go along.
Okay, but I'd like to really, like, understand what that
looks like.
I would venture to say to, maybe we will, and if we don't, let me know.
Come back to, okay.
Yeah.
Yeah, I totally, I'd like to see what Elaine had mentioned too. And then you mentioned data points that you need to submit to the federal government for the grant.
Yeah.
So what, you mentioned a few of them, so how are we doing with respect to those particular data points?
Courtney's gonna speak to a few of them, so she can give us some examples, some updates. We shared out the most recent, because we only do them annually. The most recent data points we shared out were the ones that we shared with you all at the end of last school year. So
I shared those as part of my goals, the information as part of my goals in the spring. But Courtney's going to give you some fall data.
And she'll have some updated ones with the TF, the Fidelity data on the pieces in terms of how well we're doing with implementation of multi-tiered systems. So she'll, I'll let her speak to all that because she'll have the specific examples on those.
As we go through the presentation, there's a couple themes that I have questions about, but you don't have to answer them now because there's more information coming. But one is this sustainability piece that you touched on. I'd be very interested in people explaining kind of when the support of the grant, the $250K, you know, expires. What are the pieces that will be left in Reading, and what's the extent of, you know, kind of the training from different groups, not just teachers. Particularly, I'm interested in whether there's any kind of supports in the community, like trained volunteers or anything like that. We mentioned other programs where we train people in Reading at large, so I'd be very interested in highlighting that. The other piece is, was touched on earlier, was just the compliance piece of how is the training going, kind of numerically the spread with between the different elementary schools in particular, where there's a lot of different elementary schools. You've touched on that, but I'd be interested in how that plays out. You know, do we have, 80% of the teachers trained, 20% of the teachers trained, those kinds of, what's our goal?
For Open Circle or for something different?
For each, to helping to Elaine's point, what is the...
Oh, for the larger, for multi-tiered systems of support.
Yeah, so for the teacher in the classroom, you know, understanding. Oh, I'm sorry, I mean, I could just reduce it to three words and you'll probably get
no,
to
it. No, because you're giving me a good theme. I'm just going to write them down, we'll see what people speak
sure,
to, and then I'll come back to
them.
So that
sustainability, if I had one word. Compliance, if I had a second word. Make it easy for you since you're typing.
There you go.
Sustainability, compliance. So in a compliance in the sense of, hey, are there pieces here that as a district we've got to comply with because we received the grant and so there's an obligation? And then beyond that, how do we help teachers make sure students are getting an even experience across the district, complying with each best practices, whatever? And lastly, the last word is measurement. What are we measuring, right? So I know you have that 15% and the 5% in the slide, and you know, I'd be interested in when do you take measurements? I know some of this is in the slide and it's coming, but I'm very interested in what are we measuring when, and what are our measurements telling us specifically about Reading students, not just, you know, kind of research at large, but what is the challenge for Reading students, and how do we know this is working for Reading students?
Okay.
So those three things.
I'm just gonna be bold here and say, there are some questions that are coming up that are about the nature of MTSS organizationally in and of itself that I do not think are gonna be satisfied by the examples that are gonna come up, because the examples that are coming up are an illustration of MTSS. So I wanna sort of allow these folks to speak to what they're going to speak to, but also assure you that if it doesn't come up here, I promise you we will get to it. We will make sure it comes up at another time. I don't wanna try to make the square peg fit into a round hole and leave either side dissatisfied, if that makes sense too. So I'm going to write these down. I think they're going to get to a lot of it, but on a couple of these are very specific, and so I'm going to write them down and make sure that I assure you we'll come back to it at some point.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Okay. Good questions.
I'll start trying to address some of these MIPs.
Yeah, I think
one of the things I want to start out with by talking about is when we went to the grant conference this year, which is all of the 72?
78, yes.
78 grantees across the country, we were highlighted, Reading, Massachusetts was highlighted because by people at UConn, who is one of the leaders of the National School Transformation Grant, and some of the other grant providers, is that we are implementing this the right way. And the reason why we're implementing this the right way is because we are planning for the end of this grant. We are building the capacity of our staff. I'll give you one example, which is connected to this grant, and that's the youth mental health first aid. So the training of the 630 people, they are teachers, they're coaches, they're community members, police officers, parents, and the whole purpose of that, and we have trainers in district. Eric is a trainer. We have 10 trainers, I think. We have 10 trainers. So the purpose of that is that we can keep doing it. Every August, when a group of new teachers come in, one of the days is the youth mental health first aid training. So that's an example of how we are building the capacity. So when the grant ends in 3 years, all of the training that we're doing is building the capacity of our staff, and also we're creating trainers in these areas for the different components. Because the training focuses on the framework. It's not a program, it's not a verb, we're not MTSSing people. It's a framework on how we're gonna address academic, social, emotional, and behavioral. And that's the consistent thing. Where we have to always start is with outcomes. Outcomes should be driving our systems data, our systems and practices. And so, obviously, what we want to make sure is we have the health and well-being of our children so that they're ready to learn. That's really what the outcomes is. So when I was presenting the district improvement plan in November to the school committee, and I apologize that this is cut off. I don't understand why this is showing this way, but you have in your hand the PowerPoint that shows the full slides. We had four focus areas with the one goal of closing the, making sure that all students can learn. We had four focus areas that we are focusing on, pardon the pun, as a school district. One is closing the achievement gap, another is literacy, another is the mathematic practices, and the fourth is social-emotional learning. You're gonna hear mostly about the social-emotional learning tonight. Next week, you're gonna hear about the mathematical practices. A few weeks ago, you heard about the literacy. And the closing of the achievement gap is all of these put together. That our goal is to close the achievement gap between our high needs kids who are struggling and the general student population. So underneath each of these four focus areas, what you are seeing, these are our outcomes. And this is what I presented to you in the district improvement plan in November. Under each one are the outcomes on where we want to see ourselves in 3 years. And the data that we're using to measure that, Courtney's going to talk a little bit about that data. So this is the same thing that you just saw, only in larger print. So action plan A, closing the achievement gap. Action plan B is literacy. Some of this is driven by state assessment. Other, it's going to be driven by local assessment that we're developing and starting to implement. And then the social emotional learning, Courtney's going to show you some of that data this evening. So the systems piece is the next piece. And here's, we're going to show you a coherence of the district improvement plan goal. So this is the goal that I showed you, if you remember, in November. Over the next 3 years, Reading Public Schools will increase student engagement, improve academic achievement, decrease discipline referrals, and enhance parent and community two-way communication. And we will address the academic, social, emotional, and behavioral health needs through multi-tiered system framework of data, systems, practices. That's a common thing that you're going to be hearing. If you remember, I presented to you the four focus areas, which were the same ones I just showed you with the outcomes. These are the steps that we're taking in those four focus areas. And then if you remember, we had a fifth focus area, communication, which was integrated throughout all of them. And actually, Sarah's going to talk a little bit about that later and how we're going to use some grant funding to start talking about all of these things to the community and showing the practices that are happening. So the fifth focus area is communication, is integrated among all of the pieces. Also, we want to show that this is also a coherence from the district improvement plan to my goals, to the school improvement plans, to the principal's goals, to the teacher educator plans. So you will see an alignment because we want to make sure we focus the resources that we have on the areas that we're focusing on as a district. So school improvement plans all have goals that are aligned to the four focus areas, either one or two or three or sometimes all four of the focus areas. Teacher goals, a student learning goal, professional practice goal, are going to see some aspect of the four focus areas in their goals. So again, we're trying to do an alignment so that we're using our resources as effectively and efficiently as possible so that we're rowing in the same direction. To do this also, and you saw something similar what Sarah had presented, but you need leadership team, not only at the district level, but you also need it at each school level. So one of the things that we have in place, and again, it's this framework, is we have school-based leadership teams that are focusing on both academic, social, emotional, behavioral implementation in that building. Every grade level is represented of teachers. The principal is part of that. You also have a teacher who is the facilitator and a data coach who is a teacher. They have all been trained, again, building the capacity so that they're communicating to the rest of the staff on how we're moving forward in certain areas. Courtney's going to show you some data tonight that talks about how these things are being implemented with fidelity and each school at what stage they're at. You also need certainly funding to make this happen. Right now it's the grant funding. Visibility piece, which is the piece that with the communication and how we're going to show the community the types of things that are going on. We need strong policy. You need the principals to be a key part of this, which is why the principals are part of the district MTSS team, which also consists of the teachers, Sarah, and Courtney, and our external coaches, so that there's a coordination at the district level to the building leadership team throughout the school. And then the coaching piece is going to be the most critical, because that's going to keep the sustainability going after the grant funding ends in year five. So at this point, I'm going to turn it over to Courtney. She's going to talk a little bit about some of the data that we have been collecting for the last couple of years.
Question.
Well, good evening, everyone.
We just have a...
Oh, sure.
Oh, I'm sorry.
So, John, so, you know, sustainability, of course, is extremely important, and it sounds like we're doing a good job building capacity, but what about the leadership positions? How are they going to be sustained? Is that something we'll have to
Because the leadership team members right now receive a stipend.
Right.
So that's something we're going to have to take a look at, yes.
Okay.
Chuck. Oh.
Yes.
I have a quick follow-up on that. But all of that rolls into $250,000 a year. That's the cost of doing this.
Right now.
Okay. I just want
to. But a good chunk of that is training.
Yep. Thanks.
This might wait to the end, but your last slide, it just occurred, as I looked at that slide, one of the things that sort of hit me about that, the leadership team, the top part, the funding, visibility, political support, and policy, it just sort of occurs to me that I think we have policy. I think that one of the areas that we're struggling with as a district, not just for this MTSS, is the funding, the visibility, and the political support. So...
Yeah,
hopefully,
that's not just for MTSS, right?
Yeah, hopefully we can, I see, you know, that's a piece, those are all pieces where we as a school committee need to partner with you and really expand that, because clearly it's critical to the success here, and we see that it's absolutely critical to our success going forward as a district. So I think that this has got it right. I guess what I'm saying is, yes, this slide has it right, because if you don't have those things, you know, you're going to have trouble then working the other side of this. So hopefully we can shift that.
Yes.
Dr. Harry, one follow-up question. The leadership team that you have in your last slide, so my impression is we're doing a lot to develop skills and talents and kind of new capabilities within existing people within the district. Are there also people that are just here for the grant, that the intention is that the people that are paid for by this grant that will not be here when the grant expires, or is the entire endeavor the sharing of existing personnel within the district, or something I'm not considering?
The teachers on the leadership team, these are teachers that exist in the district.
Okay, so it's kind of part of brains that are already within the district,
correct,
not new brains.
Correct.
And are there people that are on the leadership team that are just here on the grant money only?
The only two positions that are funded out of the grant is the data coach,
okay,
and a piece of Sarah's salary.
Okay, so 1 point something FTE that comes with the grant, and
so,
then
yes,
everything else is a kind of a sharing of existing personnel and
mm-hmm.
staff. Thank you.
Yeah.
I'm sorry, Courtney, to keep you waiting there. One of the things you talked about is the diversity of and representation on the leadership team. I'm wondering, and here it also talks about the visibility and political support. I'm wondering, are there any parents or alumni on the leadership team?
There are parents on the building leadership teams. There's paraeducators on the building leadership teams. So, yes.
Okay.
Some.
Not all yet, but some.
On some of the leadership
teams. And
that's
part of the fidelity piece that, which Courtney's actually going to talk a little bit about.
Yeah, we should be able to let her talk. I'll let you talk. Thank you.
Yeah, it sounds like I have a lot to talk about. Yeah, so good evening. I don't think I've been in front of
we
you
just
guys.
Have, I'm sorry.
Oh,
I'm
yes,
so sorry.
No. Keep asking.
Just an excellent question that you had. And my question is, when we talked about the assessing right in the beginning, Sarah, in your talk, you talked about it kind of making sure that we're not disproportionately affecting subpopulations. Is there an effort to make sure that the leadership team is also drawn from those same different subpopulations to make sure that we're getting a diverse group of leaders?
The TFI is made up of a number of items, and one of them actually is about equal representation of all stakeholder groups that group is leading,
Jean,
including students, including parents, community members, parents, and so on.
Gender, every other consideration.
Even from on board and believing in this model, and a skeptic, not on board, doesn't agree. Yep. Mm.
Thank you.
One more.
Yeah, absolutely.
One minute.
Yeah, go Gary.
Last question. As far as the leadership team goes at each building, how are those selected? Are they volunteers, or principal decides who's going to be on it, or is there a vote from the faculty who's going to represent the leadership team?
Just like any stipended position, there's a job description that's put up on
Talented.
Talented. And staff are alerted of the position, they apply for it. As we're also looking for representation from different groups, principals, existing leadership team members, and TA providers encourage different folks. Everyone's very transparent about wanting representation from different members. We also encourage ongoing turnover of those members, so that once you've served for 2 years, we ask that someone else from your team represent that group to get new ideas, and so that nobody burns out on it too. So that's the normal ebb and flow of how those teams are represented.
It's some of it's also specific by grade level. You have to have, you know, we try to have one at each grade level. So some of it's specific by grade level.
Secondary level is a bit more constricted right now just because of the scheduling issues. But as they revisit their schedules, I think they'll be able to revisit their leadership structures too.
And when do they meet?
Varies by each building right now, based on each building's schedule of individual members. On
some examples.
Some are before school, some are after school, some are during team meeting time, some are during department time.
Just checking. Okay, so I was going to talk to you guys a little bit about the system of data that we're building, because I think it's really important that everyone has the skills to use data to inform their decisions and inform the way we build our systems for the staff and the way that we organize our practices for our students. Data-informed decisions is my preferred phrase rather than data-driven, because it can come from many different places and it's meant to enlighten your decision-making process and not be the only factor. I guess I'll go this way. So data is a lot more than just measuring some of those things that the grant asks for, which I do, and I do that from like a more aggregate, zoomed out level, because it's a federal grant, they're just looking for the big picture. But when it comes to a building or classroom perspective, you need a lot more smaller pieces of data. And these are four areas that I like to focus on and have been working on with different schools. When the schools choose their focus area at the beginning of the year for their school improvement plan, they then identify pieces of data in each of these areas that they'd like to track that applies most effectively to their school improvement plan. They choose their benchmark based on a couple of items. This year is actually based on information that we had amassed at the end of last year, and they decided what their school improvement focus area would be on, and they chose the ensuing pieces that would inform what a benchmark would be, like where their starting point is, and how to tell whether they've improved or not on that. And so part of one of the biggest parts of making a data system is getting everyone on the same page and kind of having a new level of information literacy and knowing the difference between these four areas. So a lot of times we'll see demographics from the state and federal level. That's a zoomed out approach, but we can also look at different subgroups in our classroom or our school or our grade levels to make sure that everyone's being met appropriately. Some schools have chosen those areas as their focus. Perceptions are different surveys. I know some schools have done parent surveys to address some of their communication objectives that they were interested in addressing this year. Student learning is one that we're pretty used to seeing anyway. That's something we do with report cards, that's something we do with pop quizzes to kind of measure where students are. But you'll also see that for student learning, we also have a behavioral measurement aspect to it with office referrals and then student screeners for externalizing and internalizing behaviors. And school process is another thing that buildings, that they tend to look at from a building level, but can also look at a grade and classroom level for things like chronic absences, time out of classroom, and also in behavior, the recognition system. So how many positive behavior recognitions are happening instead of only focusing on how many disciplinary actions have been taken. So it's kind of doing both. I will go back to this one later. It kind of lines up with something that comes with these slides after this. But the next part after kind of addressing information literacy is getting everyone on the same page with how we go through a process of using data. We don't just arrive at a spreadsheet and know how to use all those boxes right away. We have to kind of set up a system of screeners, benchmarks, and progress monitoring. And I'm going to show you examples of each of those that are used at the building level and the classroom level on the next few slides. But just to kind of give you the difference between them, screeners are really shallow in a way. You're supposed to do it really quickly. It's usually a gut reaction, and it's supposed to be like the very top level of observations of whether someone jumps out at you as a flag or not. A benchmark is assessing where a student or a group of students actually is, where usually a performance benchmark, so that you can have something to compare against later and compare progress or lack of progress against. Progress monitoring is what you pick as a process to figure out whether someone is making progress or not, comparing it to the benchmark that you took at the beginning. And covering all of that is something we've talked about a lot, is fidelity, and making sure that you're doing this process the way that you said you would. If you're just doing screeners and progress monitoring, you're not going to have a very successful outcome because you have no idea what you're comparing it against. So some pieces are a combination of these, but you can't get very far if you're missing one of these. So we've been working with each of the schools to, once they pick something from those four information areas we saw on the previous slide, we then set in place a system of screening, benchmarking, and progress monitoring. And that's done at a building level and a grade level, and in some cases at a classroom level. It certainly is at the academic side, but. And using the data, it's not just meant for measuring. Like we said before, it's meant for informing our decisions, and these are some ways that we use it to inform our decisions. Whether we refer someone to SST or not, you cannot refer a student to SST without any evidence. Evidence is information. And all of these are different types of information that we receive or happen at different levels. This is an example of an assessment calendar, which we were piloting this year for the first time, getting all, working on getting administration on the same level about when we track different things. These are not things that every school looks at all the time. This is just an example of everything that we currently can track and in most cases do track. So to give them an idea of what's on the table and what they can choose from, what we think is an appropriate screener, benchmark, or progress monitoring piece. And some of it is stuff that I track, and some of it is stuff that buildings have chosen to track or grade levels have chosen to track. Okay, so this is our first kind of example of something that we've been doing. So this is an example of a benchmark. This is the tiered fidelity index, the total fidelity index, and there's one for each tier. This is just tier one. So you can see the progress that each school has made from fall to fall. This is this fidelity index is taken 3 times a year, and we took our most recent one in October, November of this year. So you can see I highlighted the two green ones to compare fall and fall, but you can also follow the progress from the benchmark last fall to know where they started and the benchmark where they've hit now. So we've made some significant gains in many schools. And the total fidelity index, particularly on the tier one, is meant to check fidelity of tier one implementation at the building level. So this is what we were talking about when we said there are items that check whether you have representation from all parties, all stakeholders on your team. Those are some of the questions on there. There are questions about communication, questions about how often positive reinforcement is used, and teams score themselves 0, 1, or 2, and this measures their progression towards getting it in place. And research shows that 70% is enough to be fully implemented. So 70 is the cutoff, not 100 here. And that's a tabular view. This is a graph of it. So the red line is that 70%.
Can we go back to that?
Sure.
Go ahead.
So is it fair to say that this is a measurement of compliance with a process rather than a student outcome or student measurement? It's a measurement of how much staff and support are doing what they're supposed to do for what you're trying to achieve, or is it something different? When you say, so let's just pick a number on the chart. Is it 57% is the first one?
Mm-hmm.
Does that mean that 50% of the items that are on a checklist that's represents a series of steps, a process that a collection of teacher staff kind of support are supposed to go through to follow this program at the school were actually accomplished? Is that what that 57% means, or does it mean something different?
Similar, but it's not exactly 50. It's not exactly like that because it's a weighted rating of 0, 1, 2.
Okay.
What it actually kind of illustrates is the level at which all the things are implemented, so the weight at which it's implemented. It doesn't count the number of items, it counts the consistency that they're implemented at, because the two is weighted as a higher consistency, and it's used in action planning, so that you do highlight the areas that you're lower on, and then you work on those afterwards.
It's from implementation science, so it's the level of implementation. Is it fully implemented? Is it partially implemented? Based on the team self-report, with all of these are done with an external coach, so they're also done with the coaching of their TA provider. They're also done with a walkthrough tool, so the questions are also not just, do you think you did it? But you have to say, is 80% or more of your staff aware of what all of your core values are? And then they actually do a third party walkthrough, and they sample at least 10 staff and ask them a certain set of questions, and they have to report out on it. And one of the items is whether or not you hit 80% or more. So there's a couple of different database questions on that to see if, based on the implementation, you've reached, for universal practices, 70% or higher on your implementation pieces.
Yeah, so not that it's like 70% implemented.
Mm-hmm.
And also students are
Students are walked through. Yeah,
students are part of this process.
Too. Yeah, they find that if you do something, if in the implementation science when you do a fidelity measure, if you've done something 70% or higher, the outcomes are impacted positively. You start to experience positive incomes based on the implementation once you hit a 70% of fidelity or higher. So that's why they encourage you to reach for a 70% or higher, because that's when you know any positive income outcomes you start to observe may be attributed to your actual implementation of whatever it is that you're implementing.
So it looks like there's been improvement in implementation really across the district, which is good news. The Parker number kind of jumps off the page at me. Do you have any theory about why?
Also I came in February of last year, so I can provide maybe part of the theory. So I know they were in transition with their leadership over there, and I think that was definitely a big part of it. And their leadership team also went through a really big transition, because several members of the leadership team now work for different districts. So they were back to kind of square one.
So they lost a year, basically.
This is really their first year of implementation because of the transition year.
Thank you.
And that's a tabular view of it. And this is the graph view. So it still has the blue bar starting at last fall, going fall, winter, spring, and then the green bar is now current fall and the most recent scores, because I wanted to give you a chance to see where all our schools are and how far they've come in just a year. So this has only been 1 year. And that red line is the 70% mark that we were discussing before. And so this is something we use for progress monitoring at different building levels, and different grade levels have chosen to use ODRs as progress monitoring through SWIS, which is one of the web-based applications that we use. The actual application has way more bells and whistles than this, and it's actually really helpful. It's able to help you drill down to time of day, ethnicity, problem behavior, and motivation for behavior, so you can track discipline actions that have happened and why they've happened, so you can problem solve to change the environment for the student so that you can maybe kind of avoid the behaviors and problem solve around that. And it's not just for individual students, it's for entire grade levels and classroom levels and small groups. And pretty much every school looks at this once a month as a school, like at their staff meetings. And then several other schools use this, like I said, at their grade-based data team meetings to use as a progress monitor. So I just went ahead and used an example of, this was from December 5th or about thereof, so I just did aggregates because we're in more of a zoomed out area right now. So I just did overall major disciplinary referrals from every school, and you'll see it goes from the most to the least, following left to right with the names there. And I also put it down here. Percent of district population is the how much of the overall population that school makes up, to kind of put this into perspective. So Barrows constitutes for about 9% of our district's population, and they account for maybe 7% of the overall ODRs, office referrals. So that kind of makes sense. And so you can, I put them there to kind of contextualize, because obviously the high school is going to have more. They have a much bigger population. So let's see. And this is one of our screeners. This is one that I've showed before, and I know is in our end of the year report too with you guys, not to the federal government. This is a screener for externalizing and internalizing behaviors, just to catch any students who might be at risk and provide the right kind of interventions or universal approaches that we might need, depending on the size of the groups. I was asked to put it next to last year's fall scores, though I would say behavior is contextual, so just keep that in mind. But these are the results on the left here. SRSS is the externalizing, and SIVS is the internalizing. So you have that on your handout there. So I'm going to go back to the slides that kind of gotten shuffled out of order a little bit. So let's you have another kind of outcome measurement, like a quick screener outcome of students from a behavioral side. Instead of relying on disciplinary actions, it's more a snapshot of a teacher's like viewing of how a student is acting in class and in settings that they interact with them. And this is just a snapshot. It's never, ever meant to be used as a diagnostic. It's just meant to kind of create an idea of who in your school, how many people in your school possibly need more than the universal supports that you have for behavior, how many kids are kind of in a moderate area. And it helps specialists kind of identify where to set up their resources and put them more efficiently in order instead of having a lot of one-on-ones. They can then kind of zoom out and see from an aggregate level and a grade level. And it's free. I don't know who put exclamation points on it, but that is a good one.
I just had a question on the back.
The graph.
The ODIs?
Yes. So I'm just curious. So we had the slides before that where you were giving data for fall in 2015. Do we have a similar, now go back to that one. Do we have a similar data on what's changed from fall of 2015 to fall of 2016?
You know, I did make one and I did think about this.
That's important. Yeah.
Yes, I agree.
You know what, when you use the word fidelity, I mean, that's gonna.
And also last year was the first time we used the Swiss app, so that wasn't used to fidelity last year. So using the results that weren't fully entered kind of versus a year where we've been really serious about entering it to fidelity now that there's a lot of things in place for them to do so and to consistently look at it, whereas it wasn't really being consistently looked at before. I just didn't feel like that would be a very strong comparison or give us very much information. When I did look at it, it did not make very much sense.
If you remember last year, we showed you that graph, and there was one school in particular, Killam, where it was a spike.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And one of the things that we discovered is that there was an inconsistent definition of what a major disciplinary issue was in all of our schools. So really last year was, pilot is the wrong word, but trying to figure out what was a major, what was a minor. This is the first year, as Courtney said, where everybody understands it now, everyone is implementing it, everyone is on a monthly basis recording it in Swiss. So that's why, I mean, we could have both, but it wouldn't be a very strong comparison.
But you're absolutely right about comparing it, and we do compare it month to month, and especially now because we do look at it month to month, and we have those schools and grade levels doing so. So they are looking at it month to month and have had staff meetings about how to really be on the same page about what a major is and what a minor is. So
I think the word you're looking for is calibrating.
Yes.
Calibrating.
Yes.
I have a question on this. What do you make of some of the examples where the percent of district population is really disproportionate to the percent of district offenses? Is that, I don't exactly know what to make of that.
Mm-hmm.
Is that, it strikes me as problematic, but.
So I work with each of the schools like on a building basis with these kind of things. So we are addressing things that we work on creating a statement about the problem that we think there is and have things in process to see if it's improving. Again, this is why we look at it every month, and this is a couple months in just overall. And as a, sure, we don't want it to be disproportionate. That's not what we want. And that's why when we do see that and we see it at the building level, we work as a group with each of them to kind of address what we think might be causing that. Sometimes it's calibrating from the staff. Wow, okay, are people not really putting this into the central office? Are we not sending it down, or are we sending too many and really not having a really good idea about what a major is? So sometimes that's a calibration, and sometimes the calibration is more student-based. What interventions do we have for this group of students who have the same problem behavior at around the same time of day? So.
So I also think there's different programs at some of the different schools. I believe when we looked at this previously, that was one of the sort of the comments, depending
yes.
upon what programs the each elementary school in particular. But I guess I just want to say, like, I'm trying to just wrap my head. What you're going through here is showing us really in some big areas or sort of functional areas of the grant how you can use we can use the data, that you are able to collect the data and then drill down to it, but you're not necessarily showing us like the drill down. You're telling us this is what they're doing. So I just want to make sure that I understand that, and that wasn't the idea of tonight, I don't think, to drill all the way down into the data.
Right.
But I appreciate that overview, and I think that we've been talking for a long time about, you know, making sure that we are making data-informed decisions. And so it seems like what I'm also hearing is that, you know, part of the cycle is continuing to improve the data. But you're just giving us sort of a cross-section.
You're getting a 30,000-foot view.
Of some of the data. And then there's layers underneath that explode that data so that it's actionable at the school and teacher and classroom and student level. But we're just...
So can I just give a quick example that we can use this? So what the tool allows you to do with SWIS is you can drill down to location, time, grade. So let's say lunchtime, that you have a spike of office discipline referrals every single day. So you need to take a look at what is happening in the cafeteria, what practices have you put in the cafeteria that can reduce the number of majors that occur in the cafeteria each day in grade 4, lunch, or whatever. So that's what this data is showing. You're seeing the number, but you can drill down to the number, the location, the students, the type of student, and all of that.
Yeah, exactly. This is meant to be an overview of how, and just examples of those screeners, benchmarks, and progress monitoring, which is a process we do exactly like that at the building and classroom level. So you're exactly right.
I have just a quick follow-on to this then, if that's all right. So, teachers are learning, staff are learning the power of the tool. So is part of your role is helping them to look at that and understand how they can drill into the data and sort of showing them that and then being a resource, then hopefully they learn how to use the tool.
Right.
So are there teachers or staff at each school who have, you know, are developing sort of a skill at some of these different data tools and analysis that then they become sort of a resource, or are people still really calling Courtney, all right, I don't know how to work with this data. It's got to be telling me something more than I'm getting out of it, and help me.
Yeah,
is that what happens?
Sometimes that happens, but more often than not, it's I'm asked to come out to schools and give a presentation on different skills they can use to be looking at the data. My presentation's with staff. Like, I did a staff day at Coolidge where we looked at the behavior data actually as a whole entire staff, and we talked about not just what's up there, but how do you do this? Why are you looking at data? How do you do it in your own practice? And then I also went back for a second day there also to do skills, specific Excel skills like pivot tables
mm-hmm.
and things like that to build the capacity. Because you saw my position up there in the grant-funded areas, and it is my intention to make sure that everyone has the same skills that I have, because I think it's way more important for all the teachers to have the kind of things I can do than to just have me running
mm-hmm.
between all my schools.
Mm-hmm.
So absolutely one of my biggest goals is to build capacity for this, because I think it's really important to be able to use it and not just look at it.
I have a couple of questions. Thank you so much. In a historical view, what I'm seeing is what we've been talking about for a long time, a way to unpackage what's going on within the schools and across the schools and giving the teachers the tools to make change according to the data, and not data-driven, but data-informed. And I'm really appreciative of that. One of the things you keep mentioning is the need for a consistent definition across the schools. And I'm hearing major disciplinary, and I don't know what the definition of that is. I'm wondering if you can let us know that, unless I missed it.
No, no, sure. So, okay, minors would be classroom managed. Like when something happens in your classroom, you manage it, but you still kind of want to note it. This is the third time he's kind of done that. And then major is when a student needs to go down to the office. That's been the definition that we've been working on.
Okay. And then I'm looking at, and I think that Mrs. Webb referred to this, I'm looking at the differences in the percentage of district population and the offenses. And I know we're not going down into the weeds, but I'm thinking about the major offenses, and in some cases it's very disproportionate. Is that information going to be used for sculpting the programs that are at certain schools too? Will that be helpful in deciding where subgroups should be? I don't know if they're just, if the majors are, I know you just said that majors are reporting to the office. So does that also imply that they're disruptive to the rest of the student population? If Killam has 27.05 of the percent of the district offenses, is that a reflection on how effective the education can be in that school? I'm just trying to.
Yeah, that's definitely, and the best part about data is it doesn't give you the answers. It gets you to ask the right kind of questions like that. And those are questions that we're asking at Killam and at buildings where we see this disproportionality. We see these and we're like, that's not quite right. And what can we do about it? Well, I can't speak quite to the programs because that's a little bit out of my wheelhouse, but what we do use it for is to see what kind of interventions we can put in place. And if it's that much of a disproportionality, that goes back to tier one. And that's more of a universal thing. And that's something that this data process helps us ask those questions and start that journey of, you know, this doesn't look right. It's constant recalibration, trying to align what we're doing to meet the needs of our students, because it's always gonna be changing, so.
Thank you.
So this is, I mean, less of a question, more of a observation, that all of this data collection is an added responsibility for classroom teachers. Would you agree to that? Is that accurate? Or, I mean, collecting it, reporting it? You may not, that might not be in your wheelhouse, but.
There's always been, either it was a reflection form or like an office referral form or whatever the process of sending a student down for a disciplinary need. What we've just done is aligned the fields on those forms with the drop-down fields in the Swiss system. And so there has been a change in the practice so that the form is now aligned with the form that's electronic. And there's somebody in each building now, mostly administrative assistants, who are entering that. But that's the shift. It's not been something, teachers aren't going online
Really? I've heard differently, but maybe I'm wrong.
No, there's one person in each building that inputs data. Teachers are filling out the form, but teachers have always filled out discipline forms.
Really?
To
the extent they are now?
Yeah.
And this seems pretty comprehensive to me.
It's one piece of paper, and it's just check boxes with
It's that simple.
Yeah.
So if we had teachers come in here and we asked them, they would say it's a simple process.
You could ask.
I'm sure you would get the
You could ask teachers that are over here.
Do you matter if you would get
Kinda
with
awkward.
Anything?
Pardon me?
I'm sure you get the same tiered smattering. 80% would say, yeah, there's no change. 15% would say, I don't know, maybe it was a difference, and 5% would have a real problem with
yeah.
it. I'm sure it's
all right.
with anything.
And then I guess this could be Courtney, maybe Sarah. So you say that the teachers look at it, and how does, so you mentioned you went to Coolidge, and it must have been, you know, group meeting, full faculty, and you went over it.
Full staff, too.
Full staff, right. So how does it, that seems like that might be the aberration, not necessarily the common practice. So how is it looked at? I think what I'm saying is it's important, if you're going to collect data, it's really important for, you know, my experience having collected lots of data in my capacity as a department head that also was responsible for several federal grants, and then in my capacity as a grant evaluator with 20-25 school districts and substance abuse coalitions where they're collecting data. What are you going to do with that data? And I just keep going back to a question I asked you a ways back, and I'm just worried there's the capacity to do all these things is concerning to me. I just don't know if that's something that has to be looked at further. I don't know how you change that. If you think there's, you know, the capacity to really implement these things to the extent that they're going to make a big difference.
Which piece of the data specifically? I'm not sure I follow.
Well, let's just say, office referrals. You know, when they get sent down, what happens to change that? Does it change? Have we seen progress in that regard?
Yeah, I mean, and I could also ask the other folks who are in buildings to weigh in on this too, so I'm not just speaking from it myself, but I think last year was a really good example of that. We definitely stumbled. We had the buildings where they had a really seamless paper process, where they had a clear understanding of what the form was, who it went to in the office, where it was kept, and how it was processed. It was really easy to then adapt it to an electronic process because the roles were all established, the form was just swapped out for a different one. But in buildings where it was a bit more nebulous, it was challenging because they had to do two changes. They had to change to an electronic system, and they had to actually change their unspoken system, that nebulous vague system. So it was two changes at the same time, and that took time to flush that out. And that's why we said we were still calibrating and why we saw the differences and the spikes in the different buildings. So I think part of the data for us is helping us at the district side to see where do we see those inconsistencies, and that's a flag for us. Not to say that those discrepancies are even disciplinary issues, but perhaps those discrepancies are data collection issues. Perhaps those are staff challenges to understand what the question is that's being asked or how it's being processed or filed. All we know is it's a number, it's a data point, and we should start asking questions or have a conversation with someone. And that's a flag for us to say we should look at that deeper. That's what I look at from the district side of it. So I also appreciate those numbers in light of what you're bringing up. And that's what it did for us last year, was it helped us say, actually, our practice needs to change here. Our process is all kind of screwed between the buildings. And then we tightened it up, and now it seems like from the reports of the buildings that the practices are very much smoother than they were last year. They're being updated more regularly. People all understand where they're going. So.
And what about, John, how many social workers do we have now, and what levels are they? Where are they?
We
don't have any at the elementary level.
Yeah, they're not special ed specific, because we do have a social
right,
worker in our therapeutic support program at the high school,
right.
at Killam, and at Coolidge. We have one general social worker.
Susan
Hooper in the district.
Marlene is a
she's an adjustment counselor, but
which is a school social worker.
But it's a restructured position from a school psychologist position.
Okay.
So.
But her licenses.
So. But we have school psychologists in each building.
We do. Where their primary role is still the testing piece. They do work with students, but the bulk of their work is testing.
Yeah, I'm familiar with what I've seen. Anyways, my experience at the elementary level, that it's a pretty comprehensive responsibility
yep.
to do all the testing and then, in fact, deal with the behaviors. But I guess the one thing that I know we're not in a position financially to add to our faculty, unfortunately, but I think that's something that should be a priority going forward. Social workers, it's pretty commonplace to have them in elementary schools that I'm familiar with across, Eastern Massachusetts anyway, so.
A few years ago, when we were talking about budget, priorities and things that we felt we needed that we couldn't fund, I remember that page that we kept putting in the budget book, elementary social workers was always in there.
I guess I think it would be, considering where we're at with this MTSS, that it almost seems like the social worker is really a key element in all of this, making sure it works. That particularly, if they get to that narrower tier, then you can't expect a classroom teacher to respond to those.
That is correct. A tier three would not be a classroom teacher.
Right. But do we really have somebody that can address the tier three at this point in time effectively?
We do. We have not as much as we feel we need, but no. Everything you're talking about are things that, yes, we've talked about, and I've also talked about with this committee, in this community, about the need for more of social, emotional, and behavioral health help.
Mm-hmm. No, I'm not questioning it. I'm just actually supporting that notion. But I am concerned though that with the expectations that are placed on our teachers in this day and age, that this is added responsibility, and it's very important for them to see an outcome like you had talked about. And if you don't really have the full capacity to do that, it's very frustrating at that point in time where you are now the data collector and pass that data on and what's happening with it. And I've seen it happen, in my responsibility and other settings where, it's very frustrating if you're collecting this data, but you don't see change.
I agree. The one thing I would say that's encouraging is even just in 1 year, using this slightly different approach to universally support all students, we've been able to, if you look at the 15 or so percent of students that had externalizing behaviors, the yellow and the red on all the way on the left, and that has been decreased to about 9% this year. So you've got about 4 or 5% difference. That's 4 or 5% of the students that are not meeting those higher level intensity of supports this year, because the universal supports are helping them. They're sufficient, they're enough, they don't need to access those supports. So part of what we're able to do is by focusing on the prevention, we're actually lessening the caseload that's necessary for those higher level needs. We've even gone from 4% to 1.5%.
I would beg to differ a little bit in the sense that I don't think that's enough data to really make that determination.
No,
it could change.
It's encouraging, though.
It is encouraging, but it could change.
Whole, we're moving in a direction.
Could change dramatically next year. It could go to, 10 or 12%.
Sure, absolutely.
So I guess I'm not. I guess I'm just still going back to the, what are we doing with it, and are we making changes? And that graph shows we are, but by the end of the fifth year, we'll know more.
Oh yeah.
Yeah, I had a question about this slide, actually. So these measurements, and they have the two acronyms down there, explained one was internal, one was external.
Yeah, external.
So these are recognized nationally, right? These are national set ways of measuring student risk, if you would. So does this database give you any access to benchmark where the district is with respect to other districts? So there's not any kind of evaluation of your, some districts might have 25%, another one across the district in aggregate, some might have 2%.
No, but Swiss does that for us.
Well, that's what I was going with this, is what does the Swiss, we'll call it a tool program, it's web-based, so you can access it anywhere. So does it give you the opportunity to access resources outside of the district after the grant is over? And are we using those resources, meaning, and whatever they might be, because you've developed a data set over the 2, 3, 4 years and counting, then does that give you, are there things that you could access that, but for having built that data set and having this access to this platform, we'll call it, that you wouldn't otherwise have. It would be a legacy of having been part of this program. And maybe you can speak to what that would do for our teachers.
So it's housed through, it's federally subsidized, so even once the grant is over, they're still, they still make it very affordable to schools, because it's also housed by the National Technical Assistance Center. The University of Oregon holds on to it and continues to collect it for research purposes too. So they continue to learn from it, and then they make the data available for folks like us to be able to compare, also to see how other like communities are doing. I'm not sure, Courtney, did you know in the training, did they talk about any of that?
About like the payment afterwards?
No, not about payment, but other future tools or things along those lines.
No, it was more about making it, they had a lot of upcoming things to make it easier with like federal reporting.
No, so I don't know yet. We're still relatively new with it. We're only in year two. So there's, they're always telling us about new tools to use, like climate surveys, things along those lines, PDAS on the bus, you know, how to use the surveying for buses and things. But I don't know yet about beyond the life of it. Odds are if it's useful for us, we would find a way to afford it. It's pretty affordable to maintain, one of the cheapest things on the grant. So.
Just a link.
Sorry, I just have two questions. So is this student risk screening results in the Swiss tool? I'm a little confused. Okay. The Swiss tool was, there's some data that you're collecting that's in the, using the Swiss tool, that this is not in the Swiss tool. So, but this data, you collect this data, and I would assume the way that you moved from, you know, 14.4% to 10.48 is because you looked at what was behind that data, looked into that population to understand something about that population to know that you should target them, or I don't maybe understand, you know, exactly what this data is, and I'm thinking of a survey that my kids took as a pilot, and maybe that's not the right picture in my mind.
The kids don't take this. Kids,
okay.
Yeah, the kids aren't doing this.
Okay, so this is...
And this is also, again, a zoomed out view, because this was just kind of like going through it. The schools have their own graphs per grade level, and we also made heat maps to kind of identify where small groups of students need help to kind of better align the resources. That's been done at the elementary levels in particular. But these graphs are available like at a classroom and grade level that the schools look at. They don't, the schools don't really use the zoomed out one. This is just the district one.
Okay, right. So they're using the sort of more granular pieces of data. And is this a teacher provided evaluation of, again, the risk for student? And I have no idea what it is. I'm thinking of RICASA stuff. I have no idea. Like, is this risk for needing an intervention, needing a support? Or is it, did I like miss the description of what that data is?
It's a quick list of a couple different observable items, and it's at a quick pass, only about a minute per student, if that much. And you go through and you just indicate if you've seen it rarely, often, sometimes. You just put a quick number in it, you move through it fast. Like Courtney said, it's just a gut screener.
Oh, okay. So this is...
It's a screener.
Okay, this is, all right, back to the screener versus then the benchmark and then the monitoring.
That
okay,
doesn't
so
take more time.
Okay, so it's the screener, so it's sort of that quick assessment. Okay, thank you.
Sorry, so if it's a screener, then this would also be an indication of how the teacher's feeling about these students. So
correct.
If it's really feedback from the teachers that they're feeling that these students are less at risk, which would translate to not to lower on the MTSS framework, like they would need less intervention, which would make it easier for the teachers in terms of meeting their needs. Does that
less
fall?
Likely to need additional supports throughout the year. Yeah.
I just want to remind, there's a lot more to this presentation,
yeah.
So I, not that I want to cut the question short, but we have many people here that haven't presented.
Yeah.
Just one quick point. I think to really validate the data, were you going to let me?
Go ahead.
I'm sorry. To validate the data, I think it would be important for us to have teacher feedback to see Because you can look at it from a different perspective. Well, okay, you know, the tier three has reduced, but it could also be perceived by a classroom teacher that probably tier three wouldn't be a good example. Let's say tier two. Nothing's really happening. I've reported this data, and I'm not saying that's the case. I'm just saying it would be important to have the feedback from the teacher saying, this is a useful tool. This is something that I really value, and I think it's made a difference. So some type of survey that's anonymous that would, you know, support the data. Does that make sense?
Mm-hmm. Well,
thank you.
We have some teachers here, right?
I can just speak for Coolidge.
Sure.
Courtney came to Coolidge, did an entire breakdown to the staff. We broke into smaller groups, paras, specialists, teachers. The feedback that we got from looking at the data was amazing. And initially, the first question was asked was, how do you feel about data? Are you comfortable with it, or you just really don't like it? And we had people who said they don't like it. And their feedback at the end was, I can't believe how helpful this was in being able to help us look at the students. And even when you talk about tier two things, and we've talked about informed data decisions tonight, that's when they were able to start asking those questions. Even with the scores for the CIVs and the CRSS, like we saw that type of data, they can see and where it all matches up, and it really kind of helped them start asking some questions. They wanted more of it. It was probably, from the feedback I received, was one of the best like in-service days that they've had. And then Courtney did come in and work with the leadership team, which we're bringing it back to the team so it's easier to use. So everybody's involved in this.
And that might very well be the case at Coolidge, but it might not necessarily be the case in other schools.
I can only speak.
Right. So that's why I'm recommending. I'm not in a position to say do something, but I just think it's important to have that. To really validate the data that we're getting, because 5 years still isn't really enough, unfortunately. You know, I mean, you look at 10 years is considered valid data. All right, I'll shut up.
Yes, go ahead.
Okay, yeah, so we made it to the third circle. So practices, and like we said before, the systems are what we design for the staff. The data is what informs how we build those systems, and then how we design these practices and how we allocate our resources for these practices. So I'm going to show you an example of the practices that we have offered at each level. So just going to be kind of a zoomed out view again. Well, back to our triangle first, but again, I like this one in particular because it reminds us that it's a blended model. It's not just academic tiers, it's not just behavioral or social emotional, it's all of it together. And you can be in green in academics, and you could be tier two in social, you could be any combination of those things, and it helps us recognize all the different sides of our students. Oh, are they hidden? Oh no, they're here. That one was new. Yeah, it's a little cut off, but this is the elementary level one, so examples of tier one supports, examples of tier two, and examples of tier three. And since these are all informed by data, these change to meet the needs. You might have certain skills groups that arise in the beginning of the year and kind of are faded out by the end of the year because the students no longer need them, or they change in their level of intensity. So these change according to what our students need, and you'll see some of them, and I'm sure we have some other things as well.
Yeah, it's not exhaustive.
Yeah, it's
definitely
exhaustive.
Not. This is just
we were trying to show you a snapshot.
And the next page is the example of the middle school level, same goes for them. And the other part about the progress monitoring, after you make the benchmark, the progress monitoring allows you to decide when a student is making progress and can therefore just be at universal tier one instruction, or maybe if they need to move up. So that's what the progress monitoring helps us do, is decide how well they're doing in a certain support and whether they need to move to a different area. So that's where data comes in after the initial creation of interventions. And finally, our high school one as well. So I'll have that in your handout.
It's going to turn over to Lynn.
Thank you.
Lynn's going to talk about one of the practices along with, Erica, are you joining her? You're just going to say over here.
Yes. Oh, okay.
Lynn's going to talk about one of the practices that we began this year.
We piloted the SBIRT project this year to get a feel for what we're going to be up against. We opted to, after meeting several times, to do the freshman class. In the 2017-2018 school year, it's going to be required that we do 2 grade levels. So we are going to have future meetings on that to decide we will proceed with that. So as part of this new freshman screening approach, a letter went home to the parents in August identifying the testing process, a copy of the test, letting them know when the test dates were, and giving them an opportunity to opt out. It's an opt-out only program. The screening program was done in the health office as opposed to the field house where we typically do our screenings. We needed more privacy for the expert part of the process. Mm-hmm. We estimated 5 to 15 minutes per student, and we did it on Tuesdays alone. We did vision, hearing, postural, and SBIRT stations. All of these are required by the state. The staff was notified with a letter from the principal explaining the process and how we would be calling the students out of class. And the main office called the students down to us. We let them know we were ready for another few students, and they sent them down. It worked out. It was pretty seamless once we got going, and we couldn't have done it without the help of the office staff. We also had, I did most of the screening. Mary Ellen Kerwin, the other nurse that works with me, did part of the screening. She did the hearing, and I did the rest. We also had Julianne DeAngelis, the community outreach coordinator for our CASA, on hand to help us with any positive referrals. So to explain ESPR is a screening, a brief intervention, and referral to treatment as an evidence-based practice used to reduce and identify substance, alcohol, and drug use. So the students, the great part of this is I was able to get an introduction to each freshman in the high school, which is something that I've never had the opportunity to do before. So the students came down to the health office. We were able to introduce ourselves, give them a brief explanation as to what was going to be done. We directed them to the screening room. We shared handouts with them. We began the tool we use is called the CRAFT tool. That's the interview tool used to identify substance abuse in the past year. So we explained to them that we're going to ask them a few questions that we asked all our patients as part of the process of getting to know each other, letting them know what resources are available within the school community. And I asked them to be honest, and the information would be kept confidential. So I read the CRAFT tool to the students. I showed them a copy of a brain scan, which showed what happens to the human brain if students, young people, use alcohol and drugs. They all kind of got a kick out of that. They enjoyed seeing that. It was a beautiful color copy. And we gave them helpline cards, a wallet card. Julianne's card was given to them, and a hotline card for them to use as well. So a negative screening, what I did was I reinforced the positive behavior. Told them they did doing a great job. I also had that opportunity to talk to them about if they had any resources out of this building that they could go to, any family members, older siblings, people in the community. And I also reminded them of the opportunities that they have within the district, the health office, the guidance counselors, all the administrators are always available to help answer any questions. And I reminded them that if we don't know the answers, we can help them find them. A positive screening, they were referred to Julianne, who was here every day with us when we did it every Tuesday. They were just broken down into high risk and severe use. So they either had a brief intervention or a referral to treatment. Some of the students, I think, had this attitude. Somebody finally asked me. So this shows the screening and describes the different risk status that we found them to be. The confidential documentation that's kept in my office. I can have access to that if you need to be report. There will be a report required at the end of the next school year. We're not required to submit a report this year. this year to this date. We were able to schedule follow-up meetings with the students that had positive screens. And ongoing, giving them ongoing follow-up. So out of the 304 freshman students that we have this year, we had 3 parent opt-outs, 1 student opt-out. I always give the opportunity for the students, if they're not comfortable with anything that we do, give them the right to say no. So we had that 1 opt-out. We had 3 positive screens, 1 refused referral. But I've made a had a relationship with that student. The student does come to the health office once, twice a week, and we're able to maintain a relation and build a relationship where I'm asking the student questions and always reminding them that if they need any more resources, we're available. 2 people were referred and they spoke with Julianne, and she was able to follow up again with more resources. Do you have anything you want to add?
I was just going to say, you had some great insights in talking with students just around families and some of the challenges that young people face with family substance use or driving in cars with impaired drivers.
And I think that's something that a lot of students don't have an opportunity to talk about that came up in our conversation.
I'm sorry, I can finish. I just had a question.
Go ahead.
I don't know whether you find it with the opt-outs, do they elaborate at all, or they just say we're not doing it?
Most of them were via emails. They didn't give any reason why. I had one mom call me and say that she thought that perhaps the screening would put ideas into their child's head.
I would say that that's more frequent than you think. Wouldn't you say with the youth risk behavior survey?
Perception. And that's why the opt-out process is it's the parent's choice. I know that we try to answer questions if people have questions about what will happen. We did send a copy home of the questions that would be asked, so the craft 2 was part of the parent letter, so parents could review the exact questions. And the craft 2 is a evidence-based validated tool that's used in healthcare organizations all across the country.
Lynn, did you say how long it took to do each student?
We allowed 5 to 15 minutes. Some took closer to 15, some were 5.
It's a lot of time.
Well, I was doing other screenings at the same time.
Oh.
All the screenings were done at the...
I
was doing the vision, and I did the postural, and then I...
Oh, and you're interviewing them while that's going on?
I introduced myself, asked them how they were enjoying their high school year, asked them what middle school they came from, starting a little light small talk to get comfortable so they get a little more comfortable.
We met several times once the law was passed in July, I think it was signed, on the best way to do this. A lot of school districts aren't even doing it this year because you have 2 years to implement it. We felt it was important to do 1 grade this year so we could figure out what this would look like. We also thought it was going to take the whole year. And when Lynn kept coming back saying, oh, yeah, we've got half the class done, and now we're, and then when they were done, I mean, at the end of November, right? You were pretty much done with everybody. And I think it was brilliant. And this was Lynn saying, well, let's put all the screenings together that are required so that we're doing it all at the same time. Which I think has really worked out very well.
And it was less time out of class.
Mm-hmm.
That's
good.
Less than 2 hours. We do what we need to do by law and get the screenings done and keep them in the classroom.
Are the other screenings also required for all the other grade levels too? Is that every year? Sorry, I lost track.
No, we have a different schedule. I can get that to you.
To roll this out going forward, then you would probably take the same approach and apply it to whatever other screenings are required for the sophomores, the juniors, the seniors as you roll it out?
High school, we're only required to do 1 year.
Oh, for the whole high school?
Yes.
Yeah.
Oh, really? Huh. And does it have to be a freshman, or we just decided?
No, that's what we chose to do. We thought it would be a great idea to get to introduce the students some of the services.
Sounds like you could get just like the Hawthorne effect from talking to them, you know, that just, you don't really change anything, but just the fact of
being sort of that one-to-one introduction to a faculty, and, you know, sort of personally inviting them in a way, maybe they, it means more to you coming from you than it does from their parents when they say.
Those one connection in the building that they
have. Yeah, no, I think it's.
So along those lines, was there any thought to, I mean, I hear what you're saying, but maybe after they've been in the building for a year and been around the older students and maybe you'd find out more from sophomores and freshmen or just?
I think the freshman grade level was a good starting point. We have to have more meetings, and of course I'm going to communicate with Erica McNamara as to the next grade, the other grade level we should do. But we'll sit and we'll communicate that in our, with our team and see what we think.
We're going to take a look and see what also what other districts are doing. And some say you should do one middle school, one high school. Some say you should do two high schools. So, I mean, our YABS provides data that shows that maybe we need to be doing junior or seniors.
Well, that's what I'm thinking.
Yeah.
I mean,
yeah, there's a higher risk level as they age,
right.
Obviously.
Yeah.
So part of what we're looking at now is trying to gather the existing schools that have piloted this year and meet in January or February and debrief on how pilots have gone so far. We've heard varying types of pilots. We're the only one that's piloted the implemented all screenings together. So we're actually the model for most of the other folks that are planning pilots for the spring. But we've heard some schools have piloted in a manner of doing just basically putting all people in an auditorium and lining them up. So it can be done very different. That's not the intended purpose of a best practice like this, but it has been done in very different ways. So we'll be looking at kind of the scope of that and talking with the ESPRT providers and the technical assistance folks. It sounds like we've adhered to the best practices so far. But we also know it is somewhat time intensive in terms of the time on the nurse. And so if you look at the middle school, we'll have to assess what that impact will look like. Do we have the resources to do that? And then if we were to move up a grade level, we would expect more positive screens. We need to have more integrated work with guidance happening. So there's a lot of factors that we'll mm-hmm. be looking at. That's why we wanted to do the pilot, so we'd have some time to plan and roll it out.
Okay, thanks.
Yes.
My gut reaction is really positive about this personal connection for freshmen as they come in. And it also is striking me as some continuity with the Challenge Day program that happens the year before in eighth grade. So that they talk there, they find out that other people, not just them, are challenged by things at home or outside, and that they come across the boundaries of the schools. And here is someone that's giving them more time than just a vision test to connect with them around what might be a challenge for them. So I'm really liking what I hear and what could potentially come out from that. And I'm also in my mind going to the processes that are going on naturally, like with our guidance department and the individual meetings, or now the group meetings, but how that could be efficient with the use of time, but add this personal element to connect with students, hopefully before a problem blossoms. So one of my questions was, does this need to be done by the nurse, or is it also something that could be done by, like, a guidance counselor when they're working with the students around their next steps in their life, high pressure times?
I'm not sure what other districts are doing, but it's been mandated by the Department of Ed that it be the nurse.
Yeah.
The nurse is supposed to lead the screening process and conduct as many screenings as is, as from a capacity standpoint. The nurse can designate some supports, but there are the districts that are using guidance staff, and it's actually not working as effectively. For various reasons, partly it's a bandwidth issue, capacity issue, the amount of dedicated time, not locking the office down during screening time, so there's some other issues. But we will be working with guidance, as is in the model, where in terms of referral and integration of oversight and support services, that piece is there. But we will be able to train the guide staff on what screening looks like, and they can become part of the screening team. But the intention really is to have a registered nurse or a healthcare provider be actually conducting the screening because of the confidentiality piece, and then also because the health office is protected, and that also creates some support for the student if they want to come back down on that particular issue. It doesn't mean that we don't communicate with guidance or don't connect with them. It's just creates another pocket of support for them.
Thank you.
There are HIPAA rules around it. In terms of how Lynn is able to store and collect the data, there are some issues, but it is not diagnostic. So it doesn't rise to, there's some HIPAA rules that don't apply because it's not diagnostic. It is a screener. But she's done a fabulous job, and the students had lots of really nice things to say leaving the office, and the buzz amongst students was really positive. Mm-hmm. So, you know, hats off to Lynn and her team for making it work amidst a very busy health process.
I think I was skeptical. I didn't know how it was going to work out. The health office here in the high school is a very busy place. But there's a saying that school nurses have, that we see 80% of the students 20% of the time and 20% of the students 80% of the time. And this gave us the opportunity to meet 100% of the students in the freshman class.
Mm-hmm.
That's
good.
Thank you.
Great. Thank you.
Thank you.
Christian is going to lead the presentation on the health curriculum.
All right. Long way. This is just another practice that we use at the schools. It's our health curriculum. And as it says, we're promoting physical, mental, and social health of all students in ways that are appropriate to their current developmental age. We have spent a lot of time in the past year collaborating in our PLCs to make sure that these curriculums are flowing well together. All the stuff that it says here, we provide students with the skills to make safe and healthy decisions and reduce risky behaviors. On the next slide, it starts talking about what we're doing at each level. This year, we've already met as a middle school and elementary school to kind of make sure that the flow is really good. And so you'll see that there is nutrition a few times up here, and it's just touching on it so that when we get to middle school, we can go more in depth on everything. We are, in grades 1 and 2, we are taking the students out of phys ed, and we do have health classes in grades 3, 4, and 5. When we get to the middle level, we're taking the students out of the phys ed time. We take them 8 classes out of phys ed. We focus on one unit so that we can go really in depth. When we had the health teacher years ago, we didn't, you know, we were all phys ed. When the health position was cut, we, at the time and prior, it always used to be like, you know, eight days, 8 different subjects. We found that the students weren't really getting enough out of that. So we met with Erica a couple of years ago, and we really boiled it down to the 3 areas at the middle level that we felt were the most important. Again, connecting with elementary, and then we also met with high school quite a bit last year to make sure that what we're doing is getting them ready to go into the high school prepared, and again, having that flow. It is a work in progress, all right? We are trying to hit the mental, social, and physical. We're constantly talking to each other as how we can best support the students in our classes. This year, what's new for fifth grade is they are doing a puberty lesson in fifth grade this year, and that information will be going out to the parents in the new year. They are still working on their units, and they're gonna get some training for that. We at the middle level, that's something that we already do, so we're making sure that, again, we have talked to them about what we're doing, so, you know, it's not too much of an overlap, but you do need some of that overlapping stuff in the grades. I'm trying to think of some of the other things that we're doing.
Christian, I'd just add that one of the great helps was a change in the schedule that allowed for the elementary lessons to have some dedicated block time that didn't take away from their phys ed. So there was a realignment of the schedule across the elementary school. schools to allow for 10-30 minute blocks of lesson time, and that's what grades three through five, we met over the summer and met two more times in the fall to really focus in on using those 30 minute blocks as effectively as we could in aligning with middle school. Christian provided some great feedback on what they were working on, and that's where we decided to slot in some puberty work because it wasn't being addressed, and students and faculty and parents have asked for that to be added. So
just if I could just add one piece, and it's probably some of the things Gary's gonna say too. Obviously this is not where we want to be. You know, we would want a much more comprehensive K to 12 health curriculum. We had talked about if the override vote had passed, that to put health education at the middle school level. So one of the things that we absolutely need to do for next year is to take a look at how can we still try to get some more health education at the middle school level. I think we all realize 8 lessons is not enough. At a time when they are developing and going through adolescence, and you know, I think our YRBS data shows that as well. So that is something that we are going to be looking at. The two middle school principals, the health education PE teachers at the middle school level, is what can we do differently to get some more health education, even with everything going on with budget next year. So that is going to be a big topic of discussion over the next several months.
And although we devote like that time just for health, where we come in and the students know it's not PE time, it doesn't mean that we're not hitting on these topics in the rest of our curriculum. So when we're talking, you know, at the middle level, and I know at the high school level, we do Project Adventure, you know, we do different activities where we're hitting on the social and emotional part of health. It's just that we are taking, you know, an extended period of time and dedicating it solely to the health part, which prior, before the health teacher, it was, you know, kind of sprinkled in. So we've made it like all about the health during that time.
Just so, you know, I think people have heard me say this before, but, you know, 8 to 10 classes, you know, John mentions comprehensive. My area of expertise is curriculum. Have to say that 8 to 10 classes doesn't allow you to be comprehensive, and the philosophy that I think should be looked at is what is our major focus, pick a focus and spend a great deal of time and effort on that with an evidence-based curriculum. See, I'm hearing that word a lot, evidence-based, when we talk about the new grants and stuff, and I'm glad to see that, because it's so significant, the difference between having an evidence-based curriculum and a research-based curriculum. It's light years difference as far as expecting outcomes and getting outcomes. Just a comment.
What?
No, I just was gonna ask if the is there a classroom for the middle school, or is it in the gym?
No, we have moved it out of the gym. We do use the multi-purpose room now.
Okay.
I mean, granted, sometimes there's still, you know, a bigger class. What we do at Coolidge, what we do with the 8th grade is a little bit different. We actually bring them all together and do a very big research project. So they're using a lot of different tools during that time. So when we're talking, when you go back and we're talking about the health and safe and healthy choices, we're hitting a variety of topics, and we're using the library, using the multi-purpose room. So I mean, you know, we try to get into classrooms with our smaller classes.
And just I think I was writing down as John was speaking that you were saying that we're not where we want to be with a comprehensive program.
Right.
That's what
yeah.
You did say, that we would want, what we would, if an override had passed, that was one of the things that we wanted to focus on, was a K to 12 program. So, you know, just sort of, right, the 8 classes is not enough. Like the quick math, even 7 months out of the school year, twice a month. So somewhere, you know, just to have that consistency of, you know,
twice a month, right, would be good. Whether or not we can get to that or not in the schedule next year, who knows? But it sounds like you're trying to see if you can increase that. Thank you.
Yes.
The topics covered at each grade level, is that tied to state frameworks?
Yes.
Okay.
Although it should be noted that the state frameworks for health in 1999.
And they're not going to be changed soon.
Yeah. So there's a lot of things in those frameworks that need to be looked at. But that's an aside.
Yeah, I'm glad to hear it, because as I read it, there were items that I would have expected would have been covered earlier, personally. And I'm very happy we're adding puberty at the end of fifth grade, but
Lynn, didn't
we really
do
should.
That?
Didn't
we do that? The puberty.
Board of Health. The Board of Health used to run.
Board of Health.
Yeah, after school, right?
Yeah,
but
it was after school in the library.
That's
a
you
long
and
time
I involved
ago.
In getting that going, though.
Maybe we instigated it. Maybe
Thank
I did. Maybe.
You.
I think Eric is next.
Thank you.
Thank you. Do you have anything to add? Just I know that
no,
there
I mean,
did some with
yeah.
the limited resources and time that we have. I can't tell you the creativity and the amount of energy that the health educators and the staff bring to the classroom and to the students. And one of the things that I think they do a really nice job of is student projects, because it allows the students to do some self-work, and Christian talked about it, and just seeing some of those projects, I mean, they're outstanding, and you learn a lot. They learn a lot from their peers, and they learn a lot from each other. But Katie, did you want to add anything just about some of your work?
Well, and the same thing too, we've had the opportunity through PTO funding to receive some really fantastic unique learning tools, such as the Ready or Not Taught electronic babies. And so again, utilizing these babies who simulate crying for different needs, and having the parents, our students attending to those needs and doing reflective work and continuing that with conversation too. Again, really affords us, again, those unique learning opportunities, and it's an exemplar in our state standards, too. But again, we have limited time with them, meeting only for one semester, ninth grade, or 11th grade, and that's it for contact.
Ninth grade is end of the grade.
Thank you.
So just a few exciting things to share. We wanted to share one project we've been working on for about 8 months. It's called the Interface Referral Service. We've partnered with William James College. They're formerly the Mass School of Professional Psychology. Most folks know them as that name, but they've been renamed William James College. About 10 years ago, there was a project in Newton that came together in response to teen suicides. And one of the things that they decided was that they needed a better way for parents and teens to connect to outpatient providers. And that ultimately became the Interface Referral Service, which is a service that's staffed now at William James College by licensed clinicians that are enrolled in their doctoral program. They've reached their master's level licensure. They staff what's called a helpline, and they answer calls from anybody in the community that you're contracted for to connect you with a provider. The goal of the intake is to get a sense of what is the parent or the child looking for, what are kind of the common concerns. Maybe they're worried about anxiety, maybe they're having some school adjustment issues. Then they get asked a little bit about insurance, capacity to take their child to different places, kind of what location. Then the goal is for that licensed clinician to start doing research within the database that they have built over the last 10 years, including information that we built into the database from our local provider network, and match that family with at least three providers that have open appointments, can take them as a patient, and will see them within a reasonable amount of time. So what that means is it's really trying to create a match between the family and make a better fit. We have lots of families who might reach out and try counseling, don't like the way that the receptionist talks to them in the first 2 minutes of the call, and may feel like, this doesn't feel right, or parents don't even know what to ask. I mean, sometimes you just get feedback from someone that something's off and you don't really even know what you need. You don't know if they need counseling, you don't know if they need therapy, you don't know where to start. So as a parent, this gives you one number that you can call, and they're gonna talk you through it. They'll also work with you if you call those three providers, you don't like them, doesn't work out. They follow up within a week to see how did it work, do you want some new names. They're also there for the whole family. So if there's anybody in the family, elders, babies, anybody in the family can access services, so it's not limited to teens or child age. It's a Monday through Friday service, 9 to 5. It's not a crisis service, so it is not open on the weekends, and that's purposeful. It's really to connect people to ongoing outpatient therapy. So far, we've had an amazing response. We rolled out on November 1st, and our guidance counselors, school psych, and social workers have been just referring like you wouldn't believe, and parents have been calling. We've been getting people, matches have been made, people are connecting with providers, case management is happening on the clinician's level, and we had Margaret Hanna, who's the director of the program, come and meet with the community, I think it was about 2 weeks ago, at our Breaking Points screening, and she talked about the importance of that families can use it as many times as they need. So if a family has a great experience, great. If they don't, call back. We'll keep getting you connected to wherever you need to be. We also have input into who's in the database. There's 8,000 providers in the database. They've all been vetted. They have to be licensed, credentialed, no malpractice. There's also information in the database around what types of specialties they have, not just do they speak this language, but are they good with boys between the ages of 13 and 14 who have anxiety issues, you know, like that specific. So it's very, very helpful. So this is a free service that has been paid for by our grant, and then also a donation from the Reading Hospital Trust Fund. So we're very excited to be able to offer it in Reading. Reading's not the only community. Wakefield also has the service, Woburn, and then there's a list of 27 communities on the website. So if folks have family in other areas, you can recommend that they visit the website.
And if you're a resident or you work,
you work in
Reading.
Yep.
You do
so
not have a child enrolled in the schools. You can just live here or work here to be able to use the service.
So all of our town staff are promoting it, our senior centers are promoting it, any community organization, our faith leaders, anyone that works or lives in the community, it has access to the service.
So I just wanted to comment. I was wondering about contracted with, so that's excellent. Incredibly excited about the use of the Hospital Trust Fund. And I just want to say a few years ago, there was a community member who would came to several of our meetings trying to talk about how could we leverage, you know, external resources and could we bring, contractors in here. And I think this is excellent because it supports parents, the students, and our staff directly, but also enabling them to be able to help a student or parent take that next step in a really confident and high quality way. And so I think, sometimes you have to step back and reflect, this is really excellent. It didn't just like materialize out of thin air. This is like a dialogue that we've been sort of having for two years.
It's 10 years in the making, 8 months in actually getting to the service. In order to become part of the service, you have to do at least 6 months of community level work to show that you're ready. So we couldn't just become part of the service. We actually also had to show that we had the capacity among in the willingness of our guidance staff, our school psychologists, our health teachers, everyone that would utilize the service. And one unexpected piece was also how responsive the community has been because of Youth Mental Health First Aid.
Mm-hmm.
We've changed so many other community members that have, when I'm able to hand them one resource and say, you can call this number and at least have a starting point. It's much easier than handing people a big laundry list
mm-hmm.
of providers, which we also do, but it's very difficult as a parent to just look at a list and see, what do I know about these people?
Yeah.
And half the time we don't know what their letters mean and what their licensure means, and so it's overwhelming because you're worried about your child, and then on top of it, you're having to navigate what is not an easy system. So this does reduce a lot of the barriers. It also gives any adult in the community the ability to have a confidential conversation with a licensed clinician in navigating this process. So you may call and think you may need one thing, but in a conversation with the clinician doing an intake, you may be able to be directed to other resources and supports. So there are other things that they're going to help with if you need help with health insurance, if you need things to be renewed to make sure that you can access support for co-pays. There's a lot of other things that families need in order to really fully take advantage of counseling supports. So we're excited, and we'll be receiving a report every 6 months to let us know how many referrals we're getting, where they're coming from, which schools, which parts of the community. Wakefield has had the program up and running for about a year and a half. In their first year, they had 120 referrals, and about 80 of those referrals were for families that were high utilizers of school services. Mm-hmm. So they felt that was a very successful mm-hmm. matching process for them. They found it to be very beneficial. Mm-hmm. Any questions?
Yeah, how expensive is that?
It's about $12,000 a year, so it is not an inexpensive service, but we are getting 10 licensed clinicians available to our community 9 to 5, Monday through Friday.
Yeah. No, I think, you know, I think it's great too, and I'm just thinking sustaining it. Is that something that we could tap into you mentioned it before,
the Hospital Trust Fund.
The Hospital Trust Fund has donated $2,000 to the service. That was the max that they felt like they could provide. but we will be working over the next 2 years to identify other sources of support. We also felt like, even though we're not sure exactly how we're going to sustain, the need is so critical right now, and given where we have just been doing all this mental health first aid training, we felt like it was very important to use grant funds for this purpose and then try to do the sustainability work over the next 2 years to get there. So we'll be needing support and ideas for moving forward. But it is much less expensive than hiring another staff person to do this work. Mm-hmm. The beauty of it is, for our staff, particularly for our school staff, they can do what's called a third-party referral and open a case together with William James, so they can be tracking a situation with a family, so they can make sure that they're providing input if they're trying to match them and they need some other information. As long as the parent consents, they can do it as a three-part process, which is very helpful for our more complicated cases.
Which grant was that from?
This is partly through Drug-Free Communities funding. Yep. And this is under our Reducing Barriers component of the community change strategies. Because one of our needs assessment pieces that has come up over and over again is parents having difficulty accessing the system mm-hmm. and getting turned off by some of the barriers, and either not getting an appointment for 2 months, not knowing what type of provider to even utilize, and then getting frustrated and just not doing anything.
Mm-hmm. I just wanted to make the comment that the problem that you just described, I've certainly read that as a statewide and nationwide problem, an inability for families who know that they need mental health support being unable to access that for a variety of reasons. So this just seems like a phenomenal service for families to have access to.
And we have mental health parity now in health insurance, which we did not have before. So the resources are there in our health insurance for young people and other, you know, different age groups to actually have full counseling support services on a range of different areas. But if you don't know how to access the system, you may not use all the benefits that you're actually entitled to. So it's another way also for people to get the most bang for their buck out of their health insurance. And that's the other piece, is making sure they're getting the right intervention, the right support at the right time. The other thing that we're doing is partnering with our Elliott service, which I know Sarah's talked about, our community stabilization service, which is our mobile crisis response team for emergency supports. So our police officers have been trained in calling them in for psychiatric issues. So they're able to hand community members a crisis number for 24-hour, you know, weekend issues, and then on the other side, they have the interface referral for the outpatient ongoing issues. So it's very helpful with folks that are having trouble both on the weekend and during the week, that we now have two resources that we can recommend. Yeah, tier two, tier three. some other things that we've been working on, we had lots of you came to our Hidden in Plain Sight event that we offered, which was a teen bedroom we set up at the police station, and we hid a number of different drug paraphernalia throughout it, which is basically 20 warning signs for parents and adults to look for. We also looked at worries that might come up in online activity. We got a great response, about 130 parents came through, and lots of great one-on-one conversations came out of that. We also have been doing screenings of Breaking Points, which is a film about stimulant use and anxiety and stress. And we got a great response from that. We had a great panel discussion featuring some experts. That was about 2 weeks ago. We've been doing our mental health first aid. Our public safety folks just got trained in September, and now we're up to about 630 people that have been trained. We've been teaching the Active Parenting of Teens program. We've had 7 parents that have been enrolled in the series. Then you've been meeting with me on Tuesday nights. We've had some amazing discussions, and working together has been really beneficial. They've all very excited about Interface as well. And then moving forward, we're doing Active Parenting of Teens for parents of younger children. We're working on rolling out our Youth in Action clubs this spring. Last year at Coolidge, we were able to get a club going, and we're hoping to keep that going. And then we're also working with the high school. I know Dr. Doherty had a great experience this week, and Mrs. Fiorello also.
We did talk about it. Yep.
Yeah. I missed that, but you know, there's some excitement around the conference they just went to, so we'll be tapping into that. We'll be looking at bringing another speaker for parents in the spring, and we'll be continuing to offer our community education programs.
Is there a Youth in Action Club at Parker too?
We'll be looking to get that going. With the transition last year, we weren't able to make it happen, but we do have enthusiasm for this year. For the next step in data collection from our end, I help oversee the youth behavior survey, working with Mrs. Graham and Mrs. Fiorello and the health educators and physical educators. And then at the middle school level, it's a survey we do every 2 years. So we are in the bid process for the survey consultant right now. The next step will be parent information will be going out before our winter break. Parents are able to opt out of the survey if they choose. High school students will take the survey in January, and then middle school students will take it either in January or February. Some of the questionnaire improvements that we're looking at, the CDC has recommended a couple new questions on concussion. Other than that, most of the questions we already had included. We were a little bit ahead of trend. And then the data results, which will be presented to you, will be probably looking at fall of 2017.
Mm-hmm.
Do you have any questions?
Oh, I thought you.
No, I just keep thinking how appreciative I am of our teachers working together and our staff working together to make this happen, even with limited resources and time and higher needs for our students. And staying here till 20 of 10. When you have to be back at school so early in the morning, it's just, I'm just feeling a lot of appreciation for all you put into making our schools what they can be. And I just want to thank you.
I'm going to flip to one last slide that I think is important. What is it? Probably past it because it is. So I'm going to have Sarah talk about, I've mentioned earlier that we're one of the areas that we have fallen short in the assessment that we use at the district level for implementation is communication. So Sarah's going to talk about something that we're going to roll out in January.
I'll be super brief.
Yeah.
All it simply is that what, as you all cited, that the political capital, the funding, the visibility, we were weak on those buckets, right, in that slide that John showed us earlier, and that in implementation science, we need all of those buckets to be full if we're going to be successful. And so when we were talking with our coaches at the federal level, they were saying, you need to do some work to fill those buckets. And so a lot of people who are working actually work with communication partners to help with the visibility, to help with building that political capital. And so we are working right now with some communication partners to see if they can help us maximize our reach, get out to a larger audience, because everything that you've just seen is probably, I like what Lynn said, probably 20% of the people know 80% of what we talked about, and probably 80% of the people out there know 20% about what we've just talked about. And so we really need to do a much better job of sharing this, and even you're all gonna walk out of here understanding a whole lot more than what we came in knowing, but having many, many more questions and thoughts generated also as a result. So it's not only sharing a one and done, but the consistency of it, the frequency of it, the depth of it, the breadth of it, and just a common language to continue to have these conversations, to keep coming back to it, so it's not this piece that you hear about once a year and then that's it. So we're really working to figure out how to do that in an effective way, And how to actually get people to engage with it so we're not only speaking to the group of the willing, so to speak,
mm-hmm.
but actually getting to everybody who needs to hear it, because it does affect everybody in one way or another. So that's in the works. We're not quite sure what it looks like yet, but we'll have more details for you shortly.
I just want to conclude one final comment. What we're doing is very difficult work. There's no question about that. But we have a terrific team of people. Many of them are here tonight. We have many teachers that are investing time and energy because they think and they know that this is what's best for kids. We have structures in place in every building. We have a structure in place at the district level with the overall goal of creating a sustainable framework so that regardless of the whether it be academic or social emotional or behavioral, that we're able to address it for kids. We are certainly not there yet. We have a lot of challenges, and certainly funding is one of those challenges, but there are other challenges too. Consistency is a big one, and we've recognized that, and we're very transparent about that. That you know, some things are working very well in some schools, and in other schools we're not there yet, and we know that. But we feel that this is the right path, this is the right direction that we need to go, because we're the type of community that we're never going to have umpteen resources. So what we need is a framework where we're building the capacity from within to be able to do this work. So I hope that the information we provided for you this evening is gives you a little bit more insight of what we're trying to do, but we certainly know we have a long way to go.
I just wanted to make sure that we actually knew all the staff that was here today, because we didn't really meet everyone. So I just was wondering, a couple people, who are they?
Tom Zaya.
Yeah.
Who's he?
Yeah.
Who?
Courtney was
you know
there.
Courtney. Jen White is on the building leadership team. Nicole, actually, you're one of the facilitators, right?
For the MTSS.
For the MTSS team. She is a PE teacher at Coolidge. And you know Christian?
Yep.
Christian right now is the interim assistant principal of Coolidge. Katie, you know. Katie Farrell.
And then
Lynn.
There was
is
another.
Paula was here.
Yeah.
Paula Graham
was
here.
There was a gentleman who was here a few minutes ago.
No, he's a reporter for the Chronicle.
Oh. See? That's why I'm like, I don't know who this staff is.
No.
And we have. I just wanted to make sure that sometimes not everyone speaks, and then I don't know who everyone is.
I just wanted to thank everybody again for this tonight. I just two things that I really, really liked that I heard. This examples I'll take you up, one's from Sarah and one's from Lynn tonight, was the creative thinking that you did to try to take and build something out of what we already have. And I really like the example of doing the screenings where you already have to do the students have to be screened for certain physical characteristics, and then to layer this on top of it. I thought that was really great insight, really creative thinking. And I liked, Sarah, your example of using some of the forms that already exist in the workflow in a teacher's day, to the point that was made earlier. Any way we can build this with the creativity of the teams that and the expertise that you bring, we can't succeed as a community without what you as teachers do every day. So thank you so much. Nurses, staff, et cetera. Everybody's a teacher in some way.
Calendar discussion. Did you have any present?
Just very short. So you have the handout in the in your packet. Calendar that is being presented. Some of the things that I think just to highlight some main points. One is that, as we have for several years, the start date is before Labor Day. The first 2 days, the Monday and Tuesday before Labor Day, are teacher in service days, and then students would be going to school on Wednesday and Thursday. We have had Friday off, which parents have appreciated, to provide the 4-day Labor Day weekend for kids. The, there are teacher in service days built in on here in March, in November, the which would be the election day. One of the advantages that we found this year with having a teacher in service day on the November election day is that there are several other school districts that also have that day. So we were able to share resources at no cost, and that we had teachers going to different school districts. They chose to attend different professional development activities based on their needs. We also had some activities occurring here. And so that the other school districts are going to continue to do that. We would like to continue to do that as well.
Can I just ask a question? So is you say that even though the next November is it a midterm?
No,
it's not even a midterm.
It's
so
not even, but
you
the,
really think
that districts are still continuing to have that day as a
in service day?
As an in service day.
It's pretty common.
Yeah.
Okay, I'm sorry. Go ahead.
No, that's okay. We do have an in service day in March that was shifted this year, and we want to continue that practice next year. That would be our Blue Ribbon Conference Day that we have here for staff. And also we have a teacher in service day which on the Friday before vacation. So that would be a half day for students, but it would be a full day for teachers, and it would be professional development time in the afternoon that day. The one other piece that we actually had to take a look at and research that we didn't know about is Veterans Day next year is on a Saturday. Hmm. And our first reaction was is that Veterans Day would be celebrated on a Friday. That is not the case in Massachusetts. Veterans Day is celebrated on the Saturday. If Veterans Day fell on Sunday, which it will the following year, then the holiday is on the Monday. So there is school on the Friday before Veterans Day.
And that would be what, November 10th?
I believe it's, yeah, November 10th, yes. This calendar also continues the practice of what started 2 years ago, which is to have the two Jewish holidays, Rosh Hashanah, Yom Kippur, and Good Friday as school days, which is a practice that was in place prior to 2006, was stopped from 2006 to 2015, and changed in 2015. So one of the other pieces to this that school committee passed a few years ago was in a religious accommodation policy, which is actually a pretty comprehensive policy. IMDA, if you remember, we've talked about it several times. And one of the things that I think is important to note is that, like any policy, the implementation of that policy hasn't been 100% smooth. And so this past year, when we had school on the religious holidays, we did have some concerns that were brought forward by students and parents, particularly at the high school, where the accommodations policy wasn't completely implemented, that there were some classes where there were some exams given. That is being addressed. I have talked to Mr. Barker about that. He is aware of it. There are some things that we need to do differently at the district level and at each school level. I also had the opportunity to reach out to parents that had reached out to me and spoke to either them in person or on the phone about what their concerns were and how we can address them. And so a couple of the things that we need to do better is to actually communicate to parents. And I think this is a K-12 issue, but the parent I talked to about this was an elementary parent, is to send something out to parents saying, if for some reason, if you are going to be celebrating the religious holiday, to please let the office know so that we can appropriately we can appropriately put that down for an absence and code it the right way. And that way teachers also know that a student is going to be out for the religious holiday and doesn't follow up the next day by saying, oh, why were you out yesterday? Or, you know, were you sick yesterday? Or something like that. So that the teacher already knows and doesn't put the student in a difficult situation. But it's things like that, better communication at our end proactively on the front end to communicate to parents this. With teachers, we have been communicating the policy the past couple of years and the implementation. There was three separate occasions when it was communicated to staff, but we need to figure out ways of also doing a better job of that as well. The data that I presented to you in the memo talks about the student absentee rate and staff absentee rate for the different levels, both for the religious holiday and overall. You can see the totals that are there for both Rosh Hashanah and Yom Kippur.
Chuck, can we ask questions?
Yeah, why don't we read the motion and then we'll ask.
Yep.
Yes, move to approve the 2017-18 school year calendar.
Is there a second?
We're gonna discuss.
Yeah, no, I just said that's Robert's rules. Read the motion and then. So now we'll have discussion. Go ahead.
So, Dr. Jardy, just a quick question. At the bottom of that page of data, it says that this is the average daily attendance, but that would be the absence rate.
No,
that's 96.
A note for you that the average daily attendance rate in our district is 96.5%.
Can I just ask? So, were the overall attendance rate, was it appreciably different on these days, or, you know, would you view that this is just additional absence, or we don't have that data? I just was curious if the overall absence rate was much higher than the 3.5%.
No, this is the absentee rate. No, what I was giving to you as a benchmark is that the average daily attendance rate for our district is 96.5%, so that you had something to reference it to.
I guess what I'm saying, but this is not, for instance, the total absence for the, or is it? I just want to make sure.
Is.
This is the total absence, not
so
for not specifically identified as for the holiday.
So on October 3rd,
yeah,
the students that were out specifically for the religious holiday, which is a parent communicating to us that's the reason why they were out, was 0.9%.
And then the total
the overall
was below
for
before.
The district was
4%. Okay. I just wanted to make sure that I have another question. So I have another, Chuck, can I ask another question?
Yeah.
So the policy, this sort of to the point about communication and proactive communication so that the teachers can be prepared. I especially, I guess in my mind, I've been thinking more about the high school in terms of what their requirements are to comply with the accommodation policy in terms of no difficult new material, no exam prep, no tests, quizzes, homework, one-time events, no long-time group assignments due the day before or the day after. The policy actually says that 24-hour notification is required, but it just seems to me like in practice.
24 hour is no, I'm 24
it
hour.
It says in the policy
by who?
Is to be provided by the parents or the student.
The student.
For that they're going to be absent for that next day. It says it right in.
Right, and we have not done a good job on that piece, communicating to parents that they should be.
Yeah, I guess my question was, it seems like it's difficult for the 24-hour notice for a teacher to know. So does the policy would mean that, so without the teacher knowing specifically that they have students in their class, like I think about, you know, to pick on teacher I see, you know, AP Calc. So without specifically knowing if there was a student who was going to be out for those days for the religious accommodation, you would you'd be making your teaching plan, or and just going ahead, assuming you know you don't have anyone. But then if the, you know, if the 20 that if that week then the student comes even the 24 hours in advance, and you sort of already have your layout. As I look at the calendar for next year, so does that mean that teachers need to just plan on for those days, which would be, you know, this four days in September, that they have to plan their curriculum and their execution of their day to comply to the policy entirely? Or I guess I'm just like in practice.
Yes.
So
now again, but as I preface this, the district needs to do a better job of communicating to parents to notify the school that their child is going to be out. So we need to do a better job in advance, not 24 hours, but in advance, 2 weeks, 1 week, so that parents can let the office know. We have not done that. Conversations I had with parents, that was one of the things that came out that we need to do a better job of.
Right, because I just, you know, I recall, I think I was on the committee when we first implemented the policy for the holiday to have the days off. And, you know, I recall that from during that time period, we were also getting calls from parents about how broken up the school year
That's
was
correct.
And the day, and we just sort of can't get going. And so in response somewhat to that, we developed, the accommodation policy was developed, I guess at some point. I don't know if I was on the board, so it's only since 2015.
It's been
but
2 years.
So I guess we just all need to work together at the policy and be able to make sure that it's really implementable, because I think, you know, there might have been some situations this year that I don't think that a teacher was trying in any way. They were trying to do their best to execute on the accommodation and just didn't quite get it. And I was trying to put myself in the shoes and saying, well, how do I plan, you know, for this September? How do I plan my my week? And knowing up front, more than a day or so in advance, would just help the teachers plan better for all students and be able to be respectful. And so I guess that would be a piece that, as I look at this and supporting this accommodation policy, I think we just have to really figure out the communication piece, both for the students and for the teachers, to be able to execute the class plan.
I think the thing that you know, in your narrative, you say there's still classes that are giving tests and quizzes. I mean, we're now entering what would be the third year of
Next
this.
Year would be the third
yeah.
year.
Yeah.
This is the second.
I mean, we have lots of policies. We have policies where about use an example, the chemical health policy, where if a student violates that, there's consequences. Are there consequences for teachers that are not adhering to this policy? I mean, it's the same thing. I mean, non-adherence
the,
to a policy.
There, the evaluation process is what is used when you have situations like this, yes.
But I don't know where I saw it. I know I read something about some details. And I just want to say that I don't, what I read, really, in both cases, the student probably felt uncomfortable and felt mistreated and disrespected, but the teacher also felt like he or she was trying to execute in their understanding. And so we just need to really try to do a much better job of this. But I look at it myself and I sort of say, again, I'm sorry, on APBC Calc over here. There you go. So, you know, you're teaching this class, and it's, sorry, I'm going to look at my calendar, and it's the week of September 13th, and you're trying to lay out what you're doing the following week. And you just need to know, if you have to juggle that to accommodate or not, or do you just not for those 3 days,
Or, and again, I have the question about the sundown days, but do you not teach any difficult material, no exam prep, no tests, no quizzes, no homework, even though there might not be a student in the class who
yes.
is going to be absent?
Yes, you have to make the assumption, because you may not know. And
I,
that's always been communicated. That piece has always been communicated.
I guess I think we need to do better, because I think that is, that's very difficult, and you're saying that, that the teacher would have to execute on that, even if there are no students that are in the class and going to exercise the
right.
accommodation.
Here's, you don't always know who in your class is practicing any religion.
Right, I guess we have a 24-hour...
Is it appropriate to ask the question?
There's a 24-hour... I guess I would like us to do a really good job at executing the policy.
We're doing the best we can.
I know, I just think we need
communication
more communication.
And what, in the best we can with it.
Right.
And I told you, that is something we have to work on.
Right, I feel like, and I agree, it's, you know, there are the students who need the accommodation and need to be respected, but there's also the rest of the students in the class who, and I'm probably going to be wildly unpopular, and good thing I'm not up for re-election, but the who also are in the class and, you know, would be like, geez, so we, you know, what are we doing with this week? Because we can't do anything new. Or
so if I can explain the process, the first week of school,
yep.
a memo goes out to all staff each year about accommodations. The religious holidays, when they are, not just the Jewish holidays.
No,
but all of the, no, if I could explain the process.
Yeah.
So they get it as a memo the first week of school.
Yeah.
Okay? They also, as part of this year, had mandatory training the first 2 days of school, which one of the things that they had to do was read that policy
mm-hmm.
and sign off that they read it. We have all kinds of mandatory training that we have to do by law.
Okay.
So the teachers had to read the policy. We included that this year as an extra step that we had not done in previous years. As we get closer to the Rosh Hashanah,
yeah.
which is the first one, in the newsletter that I send out every Sunday, right on the front, above the fold, as people like to, was another communication about we are getting close to religious holiday, here's the policy, here's the accommodation. So basically took the memo from the first week,
yeah.
did it again. When Yom Kippur comes out, the next religious holiday, same thing happens in the newsletter.
Can I?
So they received the communication three times. I think the misunderstanding, which is something I need to work with the principals on, is that I think staff feel that they're trying to do what's best for the student. That's the teacher's role. But in doing that, they feel that giving a choice is in the best interest, but they're not following the policy, and they don't have that choice.
Mm-hmm.
The policy says do not give tests on that day.
Can I ask just a clarification on the sundown? Can I just ask, when the holiday starts on sundown of that day, does that mean that does that apply to that school day? That they cannot do the difficult material, exam prep, tests, quizzes on that day, or is that allowed? They can still do the tests, the quizzes, exam prep.
On the actual religious holiday?
No, on when it starts on sundown.
Once it starts, the policy goes
away. So once it starts, so
yes,
like on the 20th, on the next year.
Couldn't give them homework that night.
Couldn't give them homework.
Because they were calling data
assigned. Okay.
They worked with them during the day.
Right, so you could do anything, all the things, there are no restrictions on what you can do in the classroom on the day when it starts at sundown. But
correct.
Then the restrictions are after. Okay.
So what I hear, I think that Mrs. Webb is asking, is if there are no students known, it's not about whether they're known or not, but if there is no one that is going to miss that class, why can't the teacher teach as though it's a normal day? And am I getting your question
yeah,
right?
Yeah, that's sort of what I'm
So asking. I asked this question when we were formulating the accommodations policy, and the challenge that classes align themselves across each other as well. And so when then some classes can and some classes can't, then it can create scapegoats and it can be a problem in and of itself, not for different classes to be able to do different things on that day. With a district-wide policy, it takes care of those people that don't say they're gonna miss for that day. For whatever reason, it's very hard for students who are of a minority, whether it's a religion or a culture, mm-hmm. to speak out. So they might be absent and not have said. That was the point I think Dr. Daugherty was making. But aside from that, if you have different rules again across different classes, then that can create its own problems.
Okay.
And that was from the talking to the teachers about that when we were formulating the accommodations policy.
This is a really quick point, but I wonder, just a thought I had Dr. Daugherty for you to take back and process, is maybe putting out an email blast just on this topic the week before. Just a one sentence reminder, everyone in the district, Rosh Hashanah is next Thursday. Not in a newsletter, not
the
with
the building principals are supposed to do that.
Okay.
That's and they're supposed to talk about it at staff meetings.
Having
I'm not saying I'm
no no
I'm
I
not
hear
saying
you.
That's being done.
I hear
but
you.
That is what
I just
is
think
supposed to be part of this.
Given
process.
The importance of this topic, and I'm glad to hear it's that's what the process is. Given the importance of the topic, I think teachers and staff get so much information that if it rises to a level of you need a one sentence email on just this so everyone knows.
I believe that is being done by the building principal.
That's great.
I cannot verify that in every building.
Yep.
I believe also at the staff meeting that is nearest to the religious holiday, this is also discussed.
Yeah. Thank you.
Any other? I know this. Did you have comments? Can you, do you mind coming up to the mic? Sorry.
My name is Ann Schwartz, and I have a daughter who's a sophomore at the high school. So just so I can share our experiences this past year, as well as actually when she was a freshman, so 2 years in a row. So when she was a freshman, I was in contact with her teachers and about a week ahead and said, just a heads up. Tali will be out of school for the religious holiday, fine. But this past year, when she's a sophomore, I put it on her, say, hey, you need to let your teachers know a little in advance. And so I think she forgot, started getting a little closer and like reminded her again. And then I sent out a message on just the day before Rosh Hashanah. So I sent it on Sunday. So a little bit's on me or her to give a little more of a heads up. But and I do think that that's a really valid point, is that I do think that parents do need to, parents or teachers, or kids need to communicate to their teachers probably a week in advance is the best, just for teacher prep. But anyway, so our experience was my daughter this past fall came home from school, so Rosh Hashanah was on a Monday, so this is the prior week. She came home on like Tuesday or Wednesday saying, the teacher said that we could have a test either on Friday or Monday, and so I was the only one who said Friday, because I know I'm going to be out on Monday for Rosh Hashanah. So I said, and so all the other kids voted for Monday. Like, that doesn't sound right. Like, Monday's Rosh Hashanah, there's supposed to be no tests. How can that be? So I sent a message to the teacher saying that, how can there be a test on Monday? And so she, I'll summarize her email back to me. It was not an oversight on my part, and I regret not having the students take the assessment on Friday. Of course, she'll be able to make it up, no problem. The students were not ready for the assessment at the start of class on Friday. So this is her message back to me on I sent a message on Sunday night, and she's replying back to me on Monday morning. So it says, if I did not assess them today, Monday, the holiday, I would have to wait until Thursday to do so as not to be in conflict with the religious holiday policy. As I explained to the class, we do not have 3 days to spend reviewing previous material, and I felt that if I proceeded with new material, then assess them on previous material on Thursday, it would be detrimental and unfair to the students. I discussed this with my colleagues and expressed my concern about being in violation with the policy, and they agreed with my plan to give the assessment today. So that is really not okay. It ended up okay. I mean, she took the test when she came back, and it wasn't a problem, but still not great. The prior year was a science class.
I'm just going to interject very, very briefly.
Yes.
Definitely continue with what mm-hmm. you're doing, but we do have a protocol where we do not discuss particular staff. So
okay.
just be careful
yes.
in how you describe
okay.
this, that you keep it very
yes.
broad.
The,
just,
the,
I'm
the,
getting a little nervous.
Right. The prior year was a different teacher, different class, and just the fact that I mentioned science just because it was an issue about science having labs, and it's more challenging for the science teacher to decide what kind of an activity to do. His little quote was, "I suppose from my perspective, missing an activity in class or a day working on a lab, or even just going over some of our current work, would be a far harder thing to make up." And his interpretation of the policy is that a test is easier to make up. So I'll do a test on the holiday, because it's easier to make up. So that was his interpretation of the policy. That ended up working out okay too, but still, our experience is that I think that it's difficult for the teachers to figure out what can we do. Mm-hmm. And so I think, as I had discussed with you when we met, I think it's really challenging for teachers to figure out, well, gee, we can't do tests, can't do quizzes, we can't do prep, we can't do, you know, can't do this, can't, what can we do? So I think there needs to be some more discussion and guidelines for teachers of what they can do. and also, like I just mentioned, I think it's really important for the parents and or students to communicate to the teachers, give them enough time to do the prep and, you know, accommodate. So I guess that's all.
Thank you.
Hi, I'm Rebecca Lieberman. I have two students in the high school. My son is a junior, and my daughter is a sophomore, and I'm writing to ask, I sent this via email tonight to ask that you please reinstate the Jewish holidays and Good Friday as days off from school. I've experienced both situations, the pre-2006, where I actually had, my older daughter had a teacher who assigned extra homework on Yom Kippur. It's just the policy just doesn't seem to work. Also, the Jewish holidays happen to cause a lot of stress for Jewish students in multiple ways. They fall at the very beginning of the school year when kids are new to these teachers, so they're not super comfortable. Like, my son went to ask for an extension on a project that was due on Rosh Hashanah, and the teacher offered him one extra day, which of course is the day after the holiday, which is still a violation of the policy, but he didn't want to push it. He's like, okay, whatever. He wound up having three tests later that week plus the project, so Wednesday, Thursday, Friday. And it was horrible, really stressful. The transcript counts in high school. He's kind of stressed out, thinking about college now. And so even when the policy requires no new tests or new material, so even when that's followed, which often isn't the case, students who miss school to observe these holidays are forced to try and catch up on all that missed homework. My son missed a review session for the physics test. That was bad. They come back and face all these assignments coming due, and it's just extremely stressful time. I was kind of disappointed in the memo that accompanied the new calendar as well, the way it talked about students being inconvenienced. These are the holiest days on the Jewish calendar and one of the holiest days on the Christian calendar. And inconvenience doesn't really begin to describe the choice. Also, those numbers you gave don't really reflect the true number, because more people might have observed the holiday if the school district had made it easier to do so by giving those as days off. It's very difficult for students to have to make the choice. My kids did everything right. They notified their teacher. I called in the absentee line. unlike my poor friend who got a call, but still, I mean, there was the mandatory drama meeting, or my son got a call at home, why aren't you at rehearsal? You know, stuff, things always seem to happen. This was true prior to 2006 as well. So I don't blame the teachers. They're doing their best. They're trying to teach kids. That's their job. So I think that the district can solve this problem by just giving these this day off. And I just heard today, just tonight, that Veterans Day falls on a Saturday this year. Could we maybe give Rosh Hashanah and then find one other day for the Good Friday? You only need to rejigger one day for next year's calendar because Yom Kippur happens to fall on a Saturday next year, and this would help Jewish students. Also, observant Jews observe Rosh Hashanah for 2 days. So you can imagine what that's like to be gone for 2 days and then have 3 days worth of makeup work and tests. And there's been a lot of talk, including a big presentation tonight, on reducing stress for students and improving social and emotional well-being, and restoring the religious holidays costs nothing, and it reduces a lot of stress for observant students. Thank you.
Just want to clarify one thing, Dr. Dar, just a question. Did we have a policy before 2006? You referenced 2006 versus...
There was no policy until 2015.
Okay, I didn't think so.
Yeah, if I may clarify something, because I just want to make sure that you understand what was in the memo. I was actually quoting...
Right.
That was a quote that actually came from the conversation I had with parents. I did not say inconvenience.
Oh, okay.
It's directly
it's
says
in quotes.
I would never say that.
Okay.
I just want to clarify that.
Right.
So that
I did realize that, but of the quotes to choose, that would be a minority position. No, I understand. I understand, but I just want to make sure that folks aren't trivializing what these mean for observant Jews. I know you wouldn't do that, but thank you. And
thank you. And
the fact that Veterans Day is on a Saturday, doesn't that give you an extra day to play with?
Quick comment. I remember specifically Pat Scatini stating the reason we were observing the Jewish holidays was based on what you're saying now, is that despite trying to make some effort to clarify that, you know, those were days that you couldn't have tests, it was still happening. So I'm not saying we should do it, but I'm just saying that was one of the reasons why he went to the observing of those holidays.
Nope. We didn't have the policy, so that wasn't in place. It was at the time, it was, you know, even though from just a perspective, he acknowledged that the data on student and teacher absence didn't necessarily support having the holiday, but whatever the conditions were, that went ahead, and the board supported that. He felt that it was important. Other districts were doing that. Were also making that decision at the time. I was reporting that after we did that, if you were a sitting board member, you would have been among people who received feedback from the community about why do we have all these days off? It breaks up the year. People who were not thinking of them as this is Rosh Hashanah and Yom Kippur, but saw an impact, you know, from their perspective to their students. So I think as a sort of a result, this policy was developed to try to basically meet all of the community's needs, you know, to be in school, to have some consistency, to get the school year going, to be able to have people practice their religious observances in a way that is supportive. And I think it just highlights, I think we need to keep at the policy and see if we can really close in on some of the gaps. That's my perspective.
The academic consistency was the biggest reason why the shift was made back. That there are years, unfortunately, that you do not have a full week of school until after Columbus Day. So that was the
I see both sides of the story, but I've definitely heard what Dr. Dardia said, the inconsistency of the school week right up through those holidays, and
So I understand both sides of it. I just think we just need to work, as Elaine said, to make sure that the policy is in place, not is in place, but is adhered to. And if it's a, you know, if it continues to be not followed, or if it's not adhered to, then we have to rethink it, I think, at some point.
Yep.
Thank you. Erin Calvo-Bacci, thank you so much for taking the time to discuss this and to follow up to Becky's point. This is something that causes a lot of stress. It's easier for me with an elementary child and a middle school child, but this past year last year with my high school student, not only was it an issue for Good Friday with the academics, it was an issue with the sports. That was a tryout day. And these are the stresses that I am really just so concerned about, that I let my daughter make her own decisions, but come 3 o'clock, that is typically when we would be observing. And for my daughter to be told, oh, she could miss the tryouts, but feeling like, what's going to be the penalty for that? And our children are under tremendous amounts of stress, and sports are supposed to be a balance, the drama, all these other things are supposed to be the extracurricular activities. Our students should not be made to feel that this is a, they shouldn't be made to choose. And we are very strong in our faith in my household. It's why I believe my daughter was chosen to be the ambassador for the eighth graders, because of our faith. And I really strongly recommend that this be taken under further discovery and look into all the aspects of what this really means to our students for all different levels, including the academics and the extracurricular activities. Thank you.
So, Dr. Daugherty, isn't a tryout a test of sorts?
They're not.
Why isn't that part of the...
It was not supposed to be tryouts that day.
Prohibited.
If there were, then that obviously was another issue I'd love to look at.
Right.
Because it's very clear in the policy that
right.
You're not supposed to have tryouts.
It says tryouts, athletic contests,
yep.
Theatricals, concerts, will...
One-time events.
Yeah, one-time events.
Essentially is the easiest way to put it, one-time events.
They can still have practices, but not
right.
Those tryouts, but the
right.
Student can't be held to any negative consequence as a result of not attending the practice.
Right.
So like the football team can still practice, but they couldn't have a tryout.
So I can't give homework, but the kid can go to drama for 9 o'clock at night. I'm asking the your policy, I'm just asking.
A drama rehearsal.
Drama,
not
sports,
a drama tryout, a drama rehearsal. Or
yes.
A practice.
So I can't give homework.
Yes, that is correct.
But they can.
That is correct.
Okay, thank you. Appreciate the clarification. Yes.
And if you recall, prior to this, we had no sports events. We had nothing happening on those days where we had school. No school. When we didn't have the policy.
And it was really
to clarify that point, you can't have, you can have a drama rehearsal, but you couldn't say have play tryouts.
That is correct.
So
one-time
one
events.
One-time thing.
Right.
Okay.
That was the whole purpose of putting the policy in, that those one-time events where a student would be disadvantaged could not happen.
So I'm in the play and there's a rehearsal that night, but I am not going to be there for a religious reason. There can be no negative impact to me for that.
That's what
correct.
The policy
yes.
says.
But the
that
rehearsal can happen. Okay, thank you.
As long as all the parents went first.
Eric Goldstein, Reading Teachers Association. Just wanted to give you an update about some of the things that we have going on. We've had some of our members, our teachers, who have voiced some concerns over the use of their personal days for the Jewish holidays. When they take them, they don't have any left after the Jewish holidays. And they met today, or some met today with Dr. Daugherty to discuss that issue. We plan on taking that up for consideration in negotiations. Thank you.
Just have a question. This policy, Elaine, that we're talking about, has that only been implemented for 1 year?
2 years.
Two years.
This is the second.
This is the second year. Yeah. So it strikes me, just for the committee, that there's two issues here in my mind, and maybe others see it differently. I mean, one is the issue of the calendar, and one is the issue of the policy, and maybe there's a third, which is how the policy is understood or not understood, implemented, to your words. So if I'm open to any ideas here of how we could address what we have before us tonight, which is the calendar, but I would be supportive of, at an appropriate time, looking at both the policy and having a separate conversation maybe with Dr. Daugherty and others about how that's being understood and implemented, and making sure that, number one, we're all aligned on the policy as it is. We don't need to make it changes or have other public hearings on the policy. It sounds like there's quite a bit of public interest in how it's been understood and experienced. So I would be interested in revisiting the policy, or at least having more discussions about it, and if it makes sense to the other board members to consider that separately from the issue of the calendar, although others may view it differently. Thanks.
So I keep going back and forth. I also understand all sides of this, and also from a very personal side of this, I understand the choices that our kids are being forced to make when there is school being held on the Jewish holidays. Having to decide to miss school in this anxiety, where anxiety is rampant, where there are tests, and whether it's that day or not, kids don't want to fall behind. They don't want to be different. They want to please their teachers, and they're in a sort of no-win right now because they can't please the teachers, because the teachers are in an equally difficult position, because some of them are also having to decide whether to use a personal day, whether to miss school, and all of them are having to decide how to use their time wisely with their students when they can't flow with their curriculum as it would normally do. Part of that is the learning curve with the accommodation policy. I really commend the accommodation policy. Again, it was a front runner. Reading took some, looked at policies, other policies, and came up with one that was stronger and I think better than what was there. And seeing the policy in practice, we've seen it a lot. We've seen, I brought this journey, front page, where teachers were reminded about what it means to accommodate students and to understand the holidays. There's a booklet that teachers can refer to online about the holidays. Just today in the consensus packet, we approved a trip, the change of a date of a trip planned by Coolidge, because they hadn't realized that it conflicted with the Jewish holidays. Kudos to our teachers and administrators for realizing that. Last year, and I think this year as well, there was a lot of juggling done to make sure the dates of the District Arts Festival did not conflict with Passover. And Pringle Pond at Coolidge has worked hard, even though they couldn't avoid Passover sometimes, to make sure that there were Pesedic foods there for students that had to eat other foods. So I think there's a lot of work that's going on. I think that the need for education is not something that's going to stop. As my rabbi said, we're Jewish forever. It's not, and our calendar is different, and there are always going to be people to educate. And it's not just Judaism, as Mrs. Bacco, Calvo Bacco, sorry, I just killed your name, said. It's not just Judaism. There's also Muslim students in town. There are lots of different religions, and so the accommodation policy, I think, is essential across the board, whether or not we have the holidays, these religious holidays, on or off. And so I think the accommodation policy is really important. I also think that it's not solving the issue for those families that need to observe their holiday and not have to make a choice between school and their holiday. I don't think, I know that percentage-wise, 52 people is small, but it's still 52 people that had to decide to not go to school. And there were others because it was actually 6.5%, which is higher than the average, which doesn't necessarily mean, I'm looking at the Rosh Hashanah numbers. So my guess is there are some people that don't feel comfortable coming out and saying I'm missing because of a Jewish holiday, or kids that don't feel comfortable going up or didn't think of it in enough time. And then once they're late, then they've got another problem because they didn't say it in time, so there are ramifications for that too. So we're not there yet, as Dr. Daugherty said. Are my numbers wrong?
I'm just trying to figure out, we're in 65.
6.5, not 65. 6.5%. Maybe I added it wrong, but when I added...
0.9%.
0.9%.
38 students.
No,
I'm looking across...
Linda's referring to the next...
The next chart.
Chart.
Down. So...
That's all
4% plus 2.4% of the kids. So that's 6.4, sorry. Percent of the kids were absent that day.
That wasn't just
of regular.
That's all students.
All.
Right. And you said that the average is 96.5% absentee rate. So that's 3.5.
That's the daily average attendance rate is 96.5%.
Yeah. Right. So that's an average of 3.5% of the children that are absent.
Yeah. Every day.
Yeah. Yes. So it's only an average, but there were 6.6% absent on the third and fourth.
But you can't 3.5.
They're the same kids.
You can only compare the 3.5 to the 4%. So it was point.
Calculus teacher.
My bad.
You were
good. Right.
It's a great class.
They take after my husband. Got it. Sorry.
Yeah.
Okay. Same kids. Sorry. My bad. How to be bad at math in public. Sorry. It's still 52 people that were faced with the decision. Did I get that one right?
Well, it's probably more than that because right. Some people chose to go to school because they felt they couldn't miss. That's why these numbers are underestimates. We don't know how much underestimates, but they're underestimates. Especially the second day of Rosh Hashanah.
There is, and that's
42. But they're the same.
It is difficult, and that shouldn't be underestimated. So it's difficult on all sides. I recognize that it's hard to have a choppy fall. I understand that it's hard for teachers to make the decision to go by. I was calling around to different towns to try to figure out what they do for their teachers. There are some towns, I believe it was Westwood, that they just take it and there are no personal days charged. The state actually, we go above and beyond what the state requires because we allow the personal days. The state, I have
it
a
can
copy.
Be, it can actually be unpaid.
Right, it can be unpaid or makeup time,
hmm?
According
Doctor,
to the state law.
You're getting a little bit into negotiations, I think.
Okay.
What's in the contract?
But my point is it's difficult for
everybody.
And we're not clear on what really can be done. So I guess part of my recommendation is that we talk with teachers about and work with teachers and parents to approve the accommodation policy and continue at it regardless of what happens with the calendar. Thank you.
Yes.
So my thought is just it should never, I don't think, have the onus on the student to self-identify in order to get the benefit of a policy that I think everybody agrees right now is applicable. And I think that's very important to make that a priority with, and it sounds like you are, but it's important to get it right, not just aspire to get it right. I don't want a student in our district to have to choose between their education and their religious beliefs. I don't want to put parents in that position either. It's just not right of us.
Yeah, but to be clear, the policy doesn't, it's not about, it's, it, the teachers are required to follow the policy regardless of whether the
I agree. I'll finish point. It's about, in my mind, what I'm speaking to is the implementation, not the language of the policy as it's written. And I just thank you for the opportunity to read again. What I'm saying is I understand that parents can call and identify the student as being out for this reason, and that's important so that you can account for that and that you don't put the student in a difficult position. At the end of the day, I don't want students to be in a difficult position either before, during, or after.
No,
right? Because of anything that is going on in the public schools. So however we implement the policy, I don't want the teachers to be asking the students, why are you out? I don't want the students to have to self-identify.
And, no, we have never,
and that's not the policy, but I don't want that to be the experience under any circumstance. I think that's important. Thank you.
I think maybe there's just some more follow-up on the policy, and I just want to say I think it's going to be very, it'll be very challenging. And I understand that we need to accommodate, but when I look and we're going to have 3 days in a row in September, starting on the 20th, where you can't give homework, and then the 21st and the 22nd. And it's going to make it really challenging on the other students as well. And I just really want to say that, because we heard from those other students when we had the holidays. And I just, you know, it might stress students out to sit in a class and not really get good new information. You know, that might stress a student out as much as, you know, missing. When you're out sick and you miss, it's stressful when you're out and you miss work. And they shouldn't have to miss, but I guess we heard a situation, and I think a teacher this past year tried to execute on the policy and conscientiously tried to maybe talk to some of her colleagues to say, you know, do I have this right? I think that this is going to be challenging, and it's probably going to require a little bit more discussion and guidance. But the calendar I support, the policy I support, we need to continue to look at, do we need to adjust the policy? But that's, we need more experience with it.
Agreed. Since I've been superintendent, when we didn't have school days and when we do with the policy, I will tell you that we had just as many complaints, if not more, when we didn't have school, because we still had the issues about tests being given the day after, homework being and projects being assigned over the holiday because there was no school. So we had, and we had challenges with athletic events because the Middlesex League doesn't have a consistent policy. So we had the same issues when we didn't, when we did have school, or we, when we didn't have
didn't
school.
Have school, right.
And I was getting very similar complaints from families about this. So
I think we went the extra step when we implemented a policy, because as you said, there's many, I don't know of any districts that have one. So you know, the fact that some aren't adhering to it, I have a serious issue with that, and that can't,
I
can't hear that again next year if we move with this.
No, these guys are raising their hand. I was going
to
move the question.
I think Chuck's original point about the accountability piece is important to me as well on this, that at the end of, say, in the spring, that we have some accountability that teachers are being evaluated in terms of complying with the policy, that they understand it. And if we need to make it more clear, if there's other ways we can improve compliance, I'd be happy to talk about that separately, but I think that's an important thing. Thank you.
Okay. Yes.
Just food for thought, you folks. If we're going to be held accountable, why aren't extracurricular people being held accountable? Because I'll be dead if I'm called on the carpet and some guy who does the same thing because they're a coach or a drama teacher doesn't get in trouble.
Well, I think we just...
I will say, John does a great job of communicating the policy. He's absolutely right. I mean, if you don't know about it as a teacher, you're just not paying attention. And we should be calling the carpet. I agree with you, if we violate it. But it's just, it's an unlevel playing field.
Well, I think the policy addresses the fact that you don't have tryouts, and stuff, but
you don't have, yeah, the one
practice would be.
If I can't do new and challenging material, but I can teach the wing option to my football team.
No one uses the wing option.
I know, Chuck.
Because it's not only not difficult, it's useless information.
For the 17-18 calendar. So you need to just find one day. Go one more day in June. Done. Well, couldn't we get to yes here? I mean, then everybody's happy for the 17-18 school year. And meanwhile, you can work on the policy in case next year's calendar doesn't give you the Veterans Day freebie.
There won't be a Veterans Day freebie next year.
Right, but so it just seems that we could make use of, we have a year where we get a couple of advantages. Saturday Yom Kippur and Saturday Veterans Day. So all you have to do is find Rosh Hashanah and Good Friday, which half the time winds up being a half day anyway, whenever it's right before vacation.
Did you have something?
Just a thought.
Oh.
I'm
sorry, you were.
I can say something.
Sure.
And this really isn't an issue up for discussion tonight, but there are professional development in-service days built in through the year. The possibility of reducing the number of those to replace the religious holidays is always a future consideration.
I think that's a collective bargaining issue.
Okay. Yes.
Just a quick one of the other ways to pursue this accommodation policy is for teachers within their grades and across grades to think creatively about how to use the time to make that feel less of a compromise for the teachers and for the students that are in class accommodating the policy, adhering to the policy.
My iPhone tells me when to go to bed.
It's telling you.
So you posted an hour ago,
you woke me up.
Any other discussion? We have a motion on the table. All those in favor of the motion? Opposed? 5-1. Thank you. Thank you for all the input and discussion.
And for sticking it out. But
yeah.
It was great information.
That was late.
Is that it?
I think it is. Can I have
yes.
Point of privilege for literally 30 seconds?
You are the boss.
No, tonight you're the boss. I just wanted to let my fellow committee members know, and the administration and anyone else is interested, that over the weekend I had a conversation with my family about the fact that my term is coming up in April. I was very happy and really proud, actually, at how supportive they were of me running again. So I reflected on it over the weekend and decided that I really like doing this work a lot, and I really like working with everybody in this room. So I've made the decision that I pulled papers yesterday, and I will be standing for re-election in April. Just wanted to let everybody know that.
Excellent.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Yes.
So I didn't realize that this was going to happen, but I've also pulled papers.
Literally decided over the weekend.
I have also decided that for 3 years I've had an invigorating learning curve. I've learned a lot. I've been inspired by the teachers and by the administration, and I would like to continue this learning curve and actually be able to give even more back. So I've also pulled papers and plan to run for the 3 year
next
position.
Right. Motion to adjourn.
For a second.
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 There you go.